Good morning, everyone. It's 9 o'clock and let's start. I'm Ron Wu. I'm the executive director for the Language Auburn at New York University. I'm very pleased again to have Dr. Nancy Cloud join us this morning. As you know, Dr. Cloud is professor emerita from Rhode Island College and is a prolific writer and educator around English language learners and the instruction of English language learning students. Let's start.
Dr. Cloud, Ron. Thank you so much, Ron. And we want to wish everyone a very happy spring. Thank you for taking your morning to be with us and to think about teaching ELA, your ELA curriculum, to entering and emerging ELLs. And as you can see, we have a broad grade range that we're trying to take into account from grade 1 through grade 8. So you'll see how I'm going to work with that as we go along. There is a detailed agenda on the Padlet. In a minute, I'll show you the link to the Padlet, but it was sent to you in advance so you could download the handouts. And we are going to start by really thinking closely about the skills of entering and emerging ELLs. We really need to have that forefront in our mind, what they are capable of doing right now in English and how we can help move them to the next level. And then the bulk of what we're going to be talking about today is how to deliver the prescribed or mandated ELA units to our entering and emerging ELLs across the grade levels 1 through 8. I'm going to introduce two model units to you, one that's lower primary and one that is middle level. And then we'll talk about non-negotiable elements of the ELA units, because we can't walk away from the objectives of the units. We have to implement those objectives with our entering and emerging ELLs. We'll talk a lot about how to plan the unit for entering and emerging ELLs, ways that we can strengthen the input for them, how we can go about the front loading and the scaffolding, and I'll be modeling that across both units. And I do want to mention, because I'm certain that this was one of the things that you noticed when you signed up for today's workshop, we'll be talking about how to work with our entering and emerging ELLs, whether we're working with them in person or remotely. And so I will be modeling some technology that we can, that is quite useful when we're working with beginners with lower proficiency ELLs. We'll talk about building reading strategies in our entering and emerging ELLs, because we want them to be strategic and active. We don't want them to wait for us to work, you know, make everything consumable. We want them to also go after the English. And we also want to show ways that we can support their comprehension. And then finally, we'll talk about writing tasks and support. So we'll be thinking about listening, speaking, reading, and writing. And we'll share some resources as we go along and also at the end. So this is the address. If you didn't go there yet, we hope that you have already gone to the Padlet. This is the shortened URL. This is a QR code that you can use to get there. There are handouts that we'll be referring to as we go along today. And then after today's session, we'll make sure that all of you get a link to the PowerPoint, because I do try to include a lot of resources on the slides. And I want you, because you're giving up your Saturday morning to be with us, and we really appreciate that. We want you to be able to relax, and you don't have to take a lot of notes unless that suits your learning style and you just like to take notes. You will have the entire PowerPoint afterwards. So one of the things that I wanted to do on the Padlet was to give you some lesson planning tools, some things that were I in the classroom right now, I would really want to have access to all the time as I'm thinking about planning for my entering and emerging ELLs and how I can support them. And of course, as you go up the grade levels, this becomes more and more demanding, because they're at beginning stages of English proficiency, but the curriculum becomes very rigorous as you go across the grades. And so how are they going to enter, for example, eighth grade curriculum when they're just beginning in English? And so that's the reason why I wanted to be able to model a lower grade unit and an upper grade unit. So of course, we know these are our five proficiency levels in New York State. And today we're going to focus just on these kids, whether they're elementary or whether they're upper elementary, lower elementary, upper elementary, or middle level. And we really want to think about entering and emerging. And what we want to have firm in our minds as we start to work with them is the amount of language that they can produce given their stage of proficiency and what type of complexity of language we can expect and promote and how much support is needed. And all of us are well aware that at these first levels, the amount of language will not be high and the amount of support will be high. But we want to have this, again, very, very firm in our mind. So I also want to remind you that student proficiency levels do vary across listening, speaking, reading, and writing. So whereas overall a student might show up as transitioning, still they might be emerging or even entering in reading and writing. So you really do need to know their stage of proficiency in each of the skills for listening, for speaking, for reading, and for writing, because kids generally, they're not identical across all of the domains. They might have one skill that's higher than another. And the traditional expectation on our part is that the receptive skills, their ability to read themselves, or if it's material within reach, or to listen to you read, or to just listen to things, an audio version of something, or to view a video, that we believe that their ability to listen or receive information through listening and reading is generally above their expressive language ability, but it doesn't always have to be the case. So this is something that we really want to explore. What we want to make sure that we're doing in a unit is to make sure that they're doing all of these things, that they're reading, they're listening, and they're viewing, because we need to build all of the skills. And then once they've received information, immediately we want them to start expressing information in English, what they've been learning by speaking and by writing. And we know that speaking, the oral language is the precursor to reading and writing. So we always want to be building very strong oral language. So one of the handouts that we put onto the Padlet for you today is a 4-page handout that shows what entering and emerging students can do and what they need. And so in listening, we know that for entering students, we should be teaching simple commands and they should be able to follow those commands, like open your book, pick up your pencil, grab a sheet of paper, whatever we're saying to them, we hope that they can follow those commands and we can see immediately if they're understanding and comprehending. And if they're not, then we can engage in demonstration. But we should be using very simplified language with a lot of recycling. I don't call it repetition because we're not just saying the word over and over, like open your book, open your book, open your book. We're recycling the language. Let's all open our book. Oh, look, Jose has his book open. And we're usually doing things like that where it's natural language. We're recycling the language and they're hearing book, 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 open, 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 but not through rote repetition. And certainly we want to allow good amount of wait time so that they can process the language that we're using. But we know that our entering students can understand simple instructions provided we give them visual support and demonstrations, and they can show their understanding by pointing or circling or drawing or selecting or matching or using gestures. And they do need information to be recycled and for us to use multiple modalities, visual, kinesthetic, tactile. We want them to gain information through all of their senses. When it comes to emerging, we're still using simplified language, repeating or recycling as necessary. We're still doing demonstrations. We're still allowing wait time. And for both groups, we would allow them to check in with a partner in their home language if they're unsure, if they're understanding. And we would continue to supplement verbal input with visual input. So I know you can read as well as I can what's on these sheets, but what I would like you to notice across the 4 pages that we'll be looking at now is that some statements are what teachers should do and others are what students can do or need, and we can word them either way. So here you can see that these are what teachers should do, whereas this is what students can do. So you might put a T where next to something that is what the teacher should be doing, and an S next to what the student can understand and process as we go along, and any of them can be reworded. So for example, if this one is what the teacher should do, allow sufficient wait time, but stated from a student perspective, it would be entering students need sufficient wait time before they respond, give them specific wait time, right? So we can word it either way. So think about that as we look at the speaking sheet. So when we're thinking about speaking, the main thing I want to stress is what you see in bold, that with entering students when they're speaking, the expectation is nonverbal, a nonverbal response that they will circle or show or underline or point or highlight, or they will answer with just one word or a short phrase like that one. And we're going to use, they do use early on keywords to show meaning. And what you see in the parenthesis is called pivot grammar, where they pivot off of one word like me, go locker, go bathroom, go hallway, go go cafeteria, or whatever they might say. And you know what they mean. They're not using a full sentence. They're just using a short phrase, and it's pivot grammar, but they are getting their meaning across. And of course, they can always use home language to express more, more involved ideas, and we want them to, especially as we go up the grades. Whereas emerging students, when they're speaking, they're using phrases or simple sentences. And you can see in the rest of the statements that are on this sheet, the kinds of things that I should be doing as their teacher to make sure that I'm supporting them to be able to respond in phrases or simple sentences. And I do want to make specific mention of this one, asking either or questions. The either or question is ideal for emerging students because the answer is in the question. So I would say to them, is this fossil a bone or is this fossil an impression? Okay, and so they just have to grab the word bone or impression and then respond. So actually you'll see that the fossil theme is the second grade module from Expeditionary Learning or Engage New York. So that either or question, I'm stressing it because later I'm going to ask you to make some questions. And the either or question is a really good one for us to ask to emerging students, whether in writing or spoken. So just remember, we're trying to remember this nonverbal or one word or a short phrase for entering and simple sentences, very simple sentences, at most an expanded sentence for emerging students. Now, of course, we want to follow their lead and push them forward. We don't want to hold them back if they're ready to move on, but we also don't want to over require a response that they're not capable of giving because then they'll remain silent and we want them to start to use English at their level. So when it comes to reading, you can see the things that I should be offering to entering students. They need predictable text and pattern text. I need home language text, if possible, to support the reading of English. I need text that has strong illustrations. It's good if I offer more than one book on the theme. And luckily for us, our ELA curricula does that because we have multi-week units that use multiple books and other forms of text. And I want to start teaching them some sight words. Sight words are very important in English because we have a lot of words like enough and through that are not decodable. Even the word the, you know, you can't decode that. It's not a regularly decodable word. They have to learn it as a sight word. And then for emerging students, I want level appropriate reading material, which means short sentences and phrases and maybe some expanded sentences. Again, I want the multiple books on the theme, and now I can start using some audiobooks so they can hear language as it's read, build their background knowledge, of course, for both groups of entering and emerging students. And with the emerging students, we can start to engage in shared reading. Certainly for both groups, we can do guided and read alouds, but also we can start to work on some shared reading where they're doing some of the reading. Okay, and then with the writing, it's very similar to the spoken language, except that they will be drawing or labeling. Maybe they'll cut and paste some information in strips. Maybe they'll give us some words and short phrases in a graphic that we give them, or in a chart or a graphic organizer. They can use clip art and other illustrations. And certainly they can write in their native language when they want to express a very detailed type of response that they're not ready to give us yet in English. And whereas with emerging kids, again, stressing that phrases and simple sentences, they too can use drawings. It's really great to use graphic organizers and concept maps with emerging students because it doesn't require a lot of language. They can write with just some simple sentences and phrases, and we don't want them just using words now, they're beyond that. So we want to take them to the next level. And again, they can use the home language if needed. I'm certainly going to model some sentences for them, and they can take some of the simple sentences that they write and begin to form some short paragraphs. So this is a sheet that, again, were I in the classroom, this would be a tool that I would want to keep out as I'm planning instruction so I don't exceed where the students are at. I give them a comfortable starting place. We want entering and emerging students to be highly participating, and that can only happen if we frame tasks for them in a way that they can perform. Another tool that I wanted you to have is this list of communicative functions that I can ask my entering and emerging students to do. So this would be in my objective. The student will find, the student will label, the student will point, the student will select, the student will locate, the student will act out, the student will circle. And this will be the way that they will express their understanding. And this could be whether on a quiz or a test, or just the way that as we're working and they're showing their comprehension, this would be what I would require them to do communicatively, because all of these things that are listed in this panel are within reach for my entering students. Whereas emerging students would also, like you'll notice here, entering can label and so can emerging, but entering is going to label with maybe single word and maybe have a word box, whereas emerging is going to label with short phrases and simple sentences. So this, you need this for when you're writing the objectives, your lesson objectives of what exactly you're going to ask the kids to do. And when you work from these lists of the communicative functions that we know are possible for kids at the emerging and entering levels, you know that the kid is capable of this. So if they don't answer, you can persist, because you know they can do this. And so maybe they don't understand the task yet and you have to model it more, but they're perfectly capable of responding in all the ways that you see on this list. So this would be another tool that I would want to have in my toolbox as a teacher to remind myself how I can ask for kids to participate. They should not be missing in action in the classroom. When we're having a class participation, any type of participatory activity, these will be the ways that I'm going to ask for my entering and emerging ways to join in the conversation. Another tool I wanted you to have, and I know you're not a WIDA state, a world-class instructional design and assessment, but there are 33 states and the District of Columbia that are WIDA states. And but the main reason I'm showing you this chart is because it's useful. They have outlined the types of supports I should be offering to students. And as you know, with entering and emerging, I'm going to use a high level of scaffolding. I'm going to combine sensory supports with graphic supports with interactive supports. How many should I use? I don't know. Watch the student. I would offer the student certain amounts of sensory supports, graphic supports, and interactive supports. And then I would say, oh, I think they need more, or they didn't need that many. I can pull back. Or maybe they respond better to sensory supports than graphic supports, or maybe they respond better to interactive supports than sensory or graphic. the graphic starts to become quite important when we get to the emerging, but I certainly can start to use charts and graphs and tables when I'm working with my entering students. So this would be another tool that I would want to have in front of myself as I'm planning lessons, just to remind myself, oh yeah, I could also use some models and some figures. I haven't been doing that. Or maybe I'm not using enough manipulatives where they're handling something. And that motor memory of handling something, we all know the power of TPR, total physical response. When I engage in action and tactile experience, I remember better. And we want to help them remember the English because they're just new to English and it's all feeling pretty overwhelming. So another chart that I gave you comes from the website and blog, empoweringELLs.com. This is Tan Huynh's website, which is out of this world, really wonderful. And he's an ELL educator who has created a lot of these infographics or iconographics. This one was one I thought you might really like to have because it expands on the one that I just showed you, but it's the same three categories of sensory, interactive, and graphic scaffolds. But he also shows how ELLs can use these and what the purpose of them are, in addition to listing them all. So I think whichever one of these you like better, or maybe working with both of them, you do need to remind yourself of the scaffolding that you can offer to students. And so his website is terrific. One of my goals today is to show you really great resources that you can turn to. All I had to do was go and find this, and in 1 second I could download it, and I have a tool that's fantastic without any effort on my part other than that 30 seconds of finding it. And this is another of his tools, and this is a fantastic tool because in the sky blue, he's showing us what teachers should be doing to scaffolding and also how much scaffolding. So he throws entering and emerging into the beginning category. He does use WIDA labels, so I replaced his labels with your New York State labels. So once kids get to transitioning, I'm really cutting down on the scaffolding. And when they get to expanding even more, not a lot of scaffolding, and the scaffolding includes more verbal type of scaffolding. And finally, when I get to commanding, I'm just monitoring the kids' use of strategies. I shouldn't have to offer much. The output also increases. So as this aqua color, as they go from entering and emerging, which is all in this one little panel here, over to transitioning, expanding, and commanding. These are all the things that I'm starting to use with kids, expecting as output from them. But what I want you to notice is, whereas this is fantastic and I love it because he's showing me the scaffolding I should be giving and the output I should expect and the type of things that kids can do by proficiency level, there's something that's not on this chart. So I want you to think for a minute of the, so far of everything that we've looked at, what isn't on this chart? So yes, I see the scaffolding and yes, I do see the kinds of ways that kids can give me output, but there's something missing on this chart. So I just want you to think about it for a second. And this is what it is. We're not remembering. He doesn't say how many words I should expect or whether I should expect phrases. And he also, while the support is shown, he doesn't talk about how many errors kids might be making. So this is back to the charts that we looked at earlier and your New York State proficiency documents. These are the language expectations that we expect from students. You should have this firmly in your knowledge base because you've been working with the New York State proficiency levels for a long time. And it's just reminding you of how much language we should expect. But remember, we want to get the output that they're capable of. So if emerging kids just answer in a single word, I'm going to push them and go, tell me more, because I know they could give me at least a short phrase or a simple sentence. I'm not going to let them just answer with one word, but I'm also going to push them to the next level. So if now they are giving me phrases and sentences, I'm going to give them feedback on errors that they're making. let's call them better approximations or miscues. Of course, they're going to make guesses about how English works that don't work out for them. So if they said something like he goed, that's a common error. We know that's an overgeneralization of how to form the past tense. Then we have to show them they're irregular. So I'm going to give them feedback so they can start to shape their language. But I'm also going to start to push them, not just to give me simple sentences. I'm also going to ask for those expanded sentences with prepositional phrases, also adding adjectives and adverbs. So I'm always pushing the kids forward to the next level while giving them feedback and support. So remember that each of these charts is doing something different for you, and that's why you need all of them. Okay, so I wanted to spend some time there. Now you noticed that in the scaffolding, everybody is suggesting to you that you use home language. But let's not forget that this is not a home language arts class, nor is this a bilingual math class. This is an ELA class. And the first class in New York State that becomes an ENL combined class is ELA/ENL. So it is supposed to be English language arts. And so now the question becomes, if I use home language, how should I use home language? How much home language and so forth? So let's take a look at that in terms of expectations.
The first time I heard a description of translanguaging, I was like, what? No way. What is this crazy idea about mixing languages and letting the students use whatever they want in the classroom? I'm a university-trained language teacher, and my whole methodological background was founded on the principle of target language in the classroom. After extensive research and study, I realized that it isn't as crazy as it sounds. The crux of pedagogical translanguaging is accepting that languages can work together in the classroom rather than in competition, and teachers can plan strategically for students to use two languages for learning. There are many strategies teachers can use to integrate translanguaging into their classrooms. The first basic structure I train teachers to use is to vary the language of input, processing, and output in a learning cycle. An example. Imagine you are teaching a history class with learners from diverse language backgrounds. You allow the students to gather information on the topic in their own languages and then bring them together for a group discussion in English about what they have learned. Then they work separately to write a story in their own language and come together in groups again to rework the stories into English. In this way, they are building their learning through one language and transferring it to the other, a powerful cognitive strategy. And in the process, they are improving their academic skills in both languages. Translanguaging is an indispensable strategy for bilingual classrooms. It can also be used very successfully in multilingual classrooms. Translanguaging pedagogy is different with younger and older learners, but is beneficial for all ages. Implementing a translanguaging approach requires an openness to innovative practice as well as professional development and coaching. But to see it in action is to clearly understand the significant benefits for learners in terms of their own language development, their English development, their content learning, and their social development.
Okay, so one of the resources that I wanted you to have, and these are two links that we're not going to look at right now, but many of you are aware that at CUNY, Ofelia Garcia and her students, her graduate students, were all working a lot on translanguaging over the past, let's say, 5 to 7 years. And one of the things that they've come up with are very clear statements of how in an ELA class, we might use translanguaging for, in this case, reading and writing. So when kids are reading, we might assign bilingual reading partners so they can mutually help one another. And of course they would need to speak the same home language. But let's say you have a very multilingual class and there are no two students that speak the same language. Still, two English language learners working together are going to really understand each other and help each other, and using their beginning English, they'll do the best to try to assist one another. So we want to make sure that we're assigning partners that can really give mutual assistance. Certainly we could give translation of novels or books that we're using, or we could use a bilingual book if it happens to be in the two languages together. And we can offer reading material in the home language and in English that's close to their level so that they can work across levels to learn the skills that we're trying to develop. We also, when they're writing, could allow them to record ideas either through writing or just speaking, first using both languages and then transfer it over to writing in English. And we will be talking about tools, especially technology tools that might be useful to you in doing that. They could have a bilingual writing partner for mutual assistance, or they could pre-write in their home language and then publish in English. They will get more ideas down if they're thinking and doing their brainstorming in their home language, that we know. And so all of these are ways that we might allow kids to work in the home language. And Jim Cummins is someone who worked on a strategy called identity text, where he was working with teachers in Canada and they were allowing kids to, on the left-hand page, write in home language and on the right-hand page, write in English, so that kids who are very literate in their home language can show their literacy to the teacher while their English is just beginning to develop. And it feels more satisfying because the left-hand page would have a lot of writing on it, whereas the right-hand page in English would just have the beginning abilities would be shown there in English. So it's more satisfying to students. They can really show who they are. So identity text, you can look that up online and see how many ENL teachers are using identity text in their writing with students. Another site that I wanted you to know about is this EL Success Forum, English Language Success Forum, because there's a lot of material there that you would find useful, including this document that has to do with ELA translanguaging strategies. And I highlighted just a few for you that when before I start a unit, I might show some background building videos or provide texts that are background building in the native languages of my students. I could also strategically pair kids so they can speak in their native language with peers during the lesson to just kind of reinforce their learning, get ideas from one another. And certainly I could have them annotate and take notes in their native language. Now, all of this presumes literacy. And if you're a first grade teacher, you might say, I don't think my kids have ever been exposed yet to literacy in their home language because of their age. So this reading and writing in the native language would only work if kids have literacy in the native language. But even if they have partial literacy, they can be using, they can be reading and writing in the native language as a support to English. And if they're not yet literate in their home language, because of their age or because of lack of exposure, because of their life circumstances, they still can listen to video and they can do other things. So I would never rule this out. I would never say, well, I don't think he or she reads in their native language, so I can't use it. Yes, you can. There's always a way to use native language, but you want to think about it. So now I'm going to show you the two units that I'm going to use as model units. And then I will be modeling for the rest of the time that we're together the strategies across these two units. One that's lower grade, a grade two unit, and one that's an upper grade unit. The upper grade unit, the grade six unit, the middle school unit exists both in expeditionary learning or Engage New York curriculum, as well as Wit and Wisdom, in case any of you are using that curriculum. But these are common subjects that we teach across the grade levels. So even if you're not teaching these units, the content of the unit should feel familiar to you, and I will be showing you that. I don't want to forget to mention to you, because it's important, that I will give you a break at 10:30 so that you can stretch and get another cup of coffee. We'll take a 10-minute break at that time. So all of our ELA units are built on these models. It's just one is in color and one is not. But I wanted to show you this one because it shows you where it comes from. And this is what was referred to by our Common Core or Next Generation ELA standards people as transformational literacy. Why did we need to make the Common Core shift? And why did they develop units in the way that they developed them? And so I want you to have this model kind of in your head as you think about delivering the unit, because this should not go away because you're working with entering and emerging students. You still want to achieve what's shown in the model. You want to give them a worthy text, a grade level appropriate topic and text that will interest them, because never mind they're just starting to develop their English proficiency, we still have to engage them in learning, and we need a worthy text, something that really will interest them. And then once we give them that worthy text, I want them to read it and read about it. I want them to think about it, talk about it, and write about it. You must be doing all of these things. This is not negotiable. This is what makes up our ELA unit. So keep that in mind as we go forward. Now, what are the worthy texts in the second grade unit that I'm going to use for modeling? This is second grade module 2, unit 1. And the unit is entitled Learning Through Science and Story, Fossils Tell of Earth's Changes. There are more than two, actually, informational texts, but these are the two that I think I could use with my entering and emerging students, not because they can read them independently, but because they have other supports that I know will be useful to me. And I will also try to help them access these two narrative texts or fictional texts. Both of them have to do with the life of Mary Anning, who was a very famous paleontologist. She was not scientifically trained, but she did learn to find fossils. And then because of her curiosity, she learned a lot more about fossils, and she helped discover some really important finds in uncovering fossils in England. So I do want to access some of the texts that make up part of the unit, but because I'm working with entering and emerging students, I can't go after 10 texts. I have to really support a few texts, but at the very least, I want to make sure they're getting access to an informational text and a narrative text. So what I want you to see is that when I enter these units, I do want to look at my second grade module, because I'm not going to give up on the guiding questions and big ideas. I'm totally after this with my entering and emerging students. I want them to know what paleontologists do, and never mind it's a multisyllabic word, I think I can help them say it. I want them to see how characters in a story respond to the story events. I want them to see how authors produce compelling narratives, what we can learn from studying fossils, and also I want them to learn more about fossils from looking at informational texts. Now, suppose you're not in the second grade, or you're not using expeditionary learning. Well, I wanted you to know fossils is going to come up. It comes up in the science curriculum for third grade, and again in middle school when we're studying plate tectonics and space science. And it also fits in middle school with geology and evolution, and in high school in earth science. So the preparation for knowing something about fossils is useful. I also have as non-negotiable the standards. When I look at these standards, I may have to modify how I implement them for entering and emerging students, but I'm not going to give up on them. I'm after these standards. I want them to see the central idea when they're reading, and I want them to be able to find some key details, and I want them to be able to summarize some of the portions of a text. I also want them to start acquiring words and phrases, to see the overall structure of a text, that text has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And also I want them to see how illustrations and highlighting and bolding and italics and captions and how all of those things work in a text. I also want them to do some writing, of course, at their level. And so these are things that I will be after with them. I want them to be able to give me some information on the topic, whether it is about the narrative that they're reading, the story that they read, or whether it's about fossils themselves as the information that they've acquired. And so I do want them to start building their knowledge, and we will be working on asking and answering questions that we can do with entering and emerging students. The speaking and listening in the standards, I think, is kind of boring, because across all the grade levels, they mostly say this, never mind the grade level, they mostly say they want kids to enter collaborative conversations. But this is where you have to keep those communicative functions in mind. How is an entering student or an emerging student going to participate? By pointing, by showing, by circling, by labeling, by naming, by telling, in a short phrase, I have to keep those communicative functions in mind. This is where they really matter, because I want to get kids into the conversations and I want them to be able to listen, to stay on topic, to ask for further explanation when they need it by saying something like, tell me more, I don't understand, or whatever they're going to say back to us. And then I do want them to start to acquire some words, some content related words and phrases. So here, as much as I possibly can, I want to work with some core texts that are from the unit that I think I can access with my entering and emerging ELLs. I didn't say this yet, but I know that for many of you, you're not working just alone with entering and emerging ELLs. Maybe you also have transitioning, expanding, and commanding ELLs all in the same room. So, but I'm going to speak today as if you just had the entering and emerging students by themselves, because I want to help you really see how to adapt the unit for them. All of these materials that I can access with entering and emerging ELLs that are grade level texts, I certainly can implement with the upper proficiency levels. And we will be having a session on April 10th on transitioning students and working with them, because it sounds like transitioning students are halfway there because they're in the middle of our proficiency levels, but honestly, they're not very proficient. We'll be really looking at that if you come back on April 10th, that transitioning kids are not very far along. It's just one step above the emerging. But I think I can enter these two that are in green are my informational texts. I think I can use them or portions of them. And I think I can use parts of these two narrative texts, or at least I should choose one of the fossil books and one of the narrative books. Now, when they put this unit together for the second grade students, they did pay attention to Lexile, because we do have Lexile expectations. What I want you to know about this chart is this chart was created for the end of the year, where second graders should be by the end of the year. And by the end of the year, they should be between Lexile 425 and Lexile 795. But we're not going to be there with our entering and emerging ELLs. So we want to pay attention to Lexile, because this is the grade level text that kids have to have a way to access, but they won't be able to read it independently because they're too new to English. So Lexile is just part of what I need to know, but I do need to know it because I want to be using books that are in the grade span. So remember that this is for the end of the year. So really I want to be still in the first grade span during the second grade year, because this is where I want first graders to be by the end of the year as they enter second grade. So I hope I'm explaining that well to you. So these are definitely within range. Okay, this is where I want to start pushing kids to. And yet you can see this Lexile 625. Well, if I'm doing this unit at the beginning of the year, this is really pushing kids, right? Even my native speakers. So do pay attention to Lexile, but with a grain of salt. I also need to think about the vocabulary demands, the sentence and passage length, and the background knowledge that kids need to understand the text. So now I would like you, with your eyes, to look at this text. I hope you can read it on the screen. And I want you, this is from The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs, the narrative text. This is the easier of the two narrative texts. But I want you to look at the sentence length and complexity. I want you to look at the vocabulary variety and level. So I want you to see the words new, fossils, cliffs, beach, climbed, pawed, hammer, chisel, etc. I want you to go through and see that vocabulary. Are they repeating fossil, 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 fossil? Chisel, 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 or are they using a lot of different vocabulary? Is there more varied vocabulary? What about the sentences? Are they just short phrases and simple sentences, or is it more demanding than that? And voice your opinion in the chat box for your colleagues to read. What proficiency level do you think could use this book easily? Would they be entering, emerging, transitioning, or expanding? Let me give you a minute. Enter your thoughts into the chat box. And in a minute, I'll ask Maria to read a few of what you've written there. So Maria, what are people saying?
Transitioning can comprehend a lot of transitioning, expanding. It's varied.
Yes, and I agree with you. I think it's not low transitioning. It's high transitioning, because look at this sentence.
Yes.
With these tools, Marianne carefully cut fossils out of the cliff, just as her father had shown her. That's not an easy sentence. Mm-hmm. That's a complex sentence. Yeah. So those of you that said expanding, I would call this middle to high transitioning and low expanding. So this is above the level of my students. But luckily for me, it has illustrations. That's why I think I can get into this with students, and I'll show you how we'll go about getting into this book. But now let's look at the other book, and let's do the same thing. Let's look at sentence length and complexity. Right away, you can see these are shorter sentences, less text, but what do you think? What are the levels that could read this book easily? Take a minute, really study the vocabulary and the sentence constructions. Okay, so Maria, what are people saying?
They're slowly coming in, but somebody said that it would be nice if the vocabulary were in bold as a clue for the reader.
Yes.
Transitioning, emerging, high emerging, and transitioning.
Yep, and I agree with you. At the lowest I could think of this, it's high transitioning, or I'm sorry, high emerging or low transitioning. But I do want you to notice that it has constructions like, had eaten, right? Like this is not simple language, right? So, and it's also verbs like rotted, like this is not everyday vocabulary, buried, protected, right? And for the person who mentioned about bolding the words, yes, if it's not bolded, I can put a box around vocabulary. I can use highlighter. For those of you that don't know it, there is such a thing as highlighter tape. It's like scotch tape, but it peels right off, and it's called highlighter tape. So if I didn't want to ruin the book, I could doctor the book before I give it to my entering and emerging, and I could highlight fish, bones, skeleton, the words that I really want them to pay attention to. And as it turns out here, the word buried is important too, because that's how this fish becomes a fossil. It gets buried in the mud. Okay, so yes, one of the things I need to do when I open the book is not just look at Lexile. This is why I'm showing this to you. I also need to use my eyes, because nobody is leveling books according to proficiency level. We as ENL professionals have to be able to level this book by proficiency level, not because then I'm going to reject it and go, oh, it's transitioning, I can't use it. Oh, it's expanding, low expanding, I can't use it. Yes, I can, but I'm going to have to work harder, and I'm going to have more scaffolding and support. So now I want to show you the other unit. Right now, I'm just introducing the units to you. This is the unit from the sixth grade, a middle school unit. And this is taught a lot in middle school, the Bud Not Buddy, because kids really like this unit. And in the expeditionary learning, these are the themes that we want kids to take away from the reading about survival and hope and fate and family and friendship, and also segregation and racism. And so I also noted, for those of you that might be teaching the unit, the kinds of writing that we're going to get kids to do by the end of the unit. But I also wanted to mention that even if you're not in the sixth grade and you're not teaching this unit, the Great Depression is taught in social studies, and it's taught in grade 8 in US and New York State history. It's taught again in grade 10, 11, and 12 in global history, US history, and economics. So the reading novels that are placed in the time of the Great Depression is useful, because kids do need to learn about the Great Depression. It turns out that it's important across the New York State curriculum. So these themes are non-negotiable. I want kids to walk away understanding that Bud is a survivor, that also doors close for him, but other doors open. A lot of his life is governed by fate or destiny. His mother dies, but he finds other people to serve the role of family. And in the end, he finds his family, his father and other members of his family. And we also see the impact of racism and segregation, especially during the Great Depression. But just like with our second grade unit, I want kids to access the standards. So here's a couple reading standards I want them to be able to access. Here I put in lighter font, entering and emerging are not ready to work on figurative and connotative meanings and analyze the impact of word choice on meaning and tone. They're just learning words. They're not ready to, they don't have a lot of words where they could think about tone and meaning, maybe a little bit, but I'm just going to work on words and phrases and help them acquire a lot of important words and phrases from the text and concepts about the text. But then I am going to work on this writing objective, of course, within the extent of production that I can get from entering and emerging students. But I'm not going to leave the standards behind. I want to access these standards. I want to plan for how I'm going to implement these standards with my entering and emerging students. Again, I'm going to have my speaking and listening standard. I'm going to have my language standard. And you'll see later how it is a language standard at the sixth grade level to help kids consult reference materials when they don't know a word. And I'll be showing you useful ones for entering and emerging students. And then here are the texts in the expeditionary learning unit. I would concentrate heavily on Bud Not Buddy because it's already enough text. Lot of text, and I wouldn't worry so much about getting into the Obama or Steve Jobs speech or the Rudyard Kipling poem. The poem's very difficult. I would be happy if I really worked through the Bud Not Buddy, and I would do some informational text about the Great Depression. So I would do a lot of the unit. These are lesser parts of the unit anyway. I don't want you to think I'm skipping important things. And so some things I would rule in heavily because it's going to be a lot of work to do this novel with entering and emerging kids. And so I can't take on a whole lot. And yet if I saw kids moving along and I thought I could access one of these speeches, I would, particularly maybe the Obama speech, because I would want to show people of color in positions of authority within the United States. I would like them to see the difference between the time of Bud Not Buddy and the time of Barack Obama. So in the Wit and Wisdom curriculum, other materials are used. They don't just read Bud Not Buddy. They don't use any of those speeches. They also try to access Out of the Dust. I don't think I can do two novels, but I can do one. And so again, I would work with the Bud Not Buddy. I could have chosen to do Out of the Dust. And then all of the things that I show you with Bud Not Buddy, you would just try to find and do those things with Out of the Dust if you really wanted to do that novel and not the other one. But I don't think I can do two grade level novels with entering and emerging kids. So I would just be after one of them, although I might read an excerpt from the other. And then what I really like about Wit and Wisdom units is they always include music and photography and historical accounts that take place through video. So they're really into the visual literacy and also the art, the use of the arts for learning. And I really like that about the units, but they talk about resilience and the Great Depression. So these are some of the things that they use in their unit. And I just wanted to give you a sense of the unit. So now let's spend the next half hour with each other thinking about how we would plan for the delivery of these units for entering and emerging ELLs. And again, I realize that for many of you, you have other levels within your class, but less modification will be needed for transitioning and above. So I really want to hone in on how to access these grade level texts. You saw that they are on grade level. And how am I going to do that with kids that are just brand new to English? They can't read the novel in English on their own. It's way, way above their proficiency level, and even for emerging ELLs. But before we do that, given that another goal of today's session is to help you think about remote learning with entering and emerging ELLs, I wanted to show you this chart, which you'll be able to get from the slide, and you'll be able to download it from this site. And this shows about synchronous and asynchronous learning and the advantages of each of these types of learning for ELLs. So when I'm working synchronously, I'm on Google Classroom in the moment with my students, or I'm on a Zoom in the moment with my students, or I'm in person, we're in the classroom together. That's great for ELLs because they're getting a lot of social clues and modeling. They're with me and they're with their peers. They can negotiate the meaning in the moment, and they can have some student-to-student interaction without a lot of effort. Okay, so when we're doing the synchronous learning, it's easier to do all of these things, and they have those advantages. In the asynchronous learning, there are advantages. I can use it for literacy development. I can ask kids, give kids plenty of time to translate words and phrases that they're encountering. They can repeat videos as many times as they want. They can repeat listening to audio. And they might be able to have more interaction with me if I set up conferences with them. And I can set up ways that they can request conferences with me. But the real thing that I wanted to show you here is the amount of asynchronous or synchronous learning, because the experts really agree that when I'm working with entering and emerging students, I should mostly be doing synchronous learning. So as an example, in Rhode Island, in Providence, they decided that entering and emerging students would only be educated in person because they felt that they need the in-person learning. Remember, I can do synchronous through remote methods. I can use technological tools to do synchronous learning at a distance. So this doesn't always mean that it's happening in person, but we know that synchronous learning is really needed by entering and emerging students because we need to be following their learning closely, seeing how they're doing. And so we don't want them spending long periods alone where they're just working on their own. We know they need support. And so this shows we can have a balance with transitioning. And then when it comes to expanding and commanding, we can go the other way. But this is not focused then on engagement. And all of you know the problems with engaging our learners when we're doing distance learning. But keep this in mind as we go along. So what I'm going to be trying to show you across the two units, and I promise that everything that I'm going to show you on these charts I will model in one unit or the other, in the second grade unit or the sixth grade unit. But basically, we have to strengthen the input for our entering and emerging multilingual learners. And so I'll be modeling all of this. And as to input, I can use home language versions of unit texts or similar texts in the home language to strengthen the input that I'm giving to my second language learners, but I don't want to only give them native language text. They need to start to adapt to access the English, right? After all, this is an ELA class and certainly not anti-native language, I'm pro-native language, but it's our goal in ELA / ENL to be teaching English. And so while we're gonna use some home language support, we also want to make certain that I'm also using that to jump in to the English. So I'm also going to look for input that might be adapted or simplified versions of my text in English. Maybe I'll have them read a section in the second grade. It's not a chapter book, but I might ask them to read specific pages, the actual page in the original version. So they might do a close read of certain pages, certain sections, or certain chapters, plus summaries of other parts. And I would be making all of those decisions. And then I can hunt for topic-related texts, maybe ones that have greater illustration, like a picture book about Mary Anning, or a picture book about the Great Depression. So I'm the one trying to find these materials because I need all of this type of input is going to strengthen the learning for my entering and emerging ELLs. all of you know about front loading, and I certainly want to do that. And front loading consists of building the background that kids need. I'll do that through photographs and other visuals, maps, timelines, and videos in the native language for front loading, because it'll go in easily. And I also want to build basic vocabulary. Please hear me, because your expeditionary learning identifies vocabulary for you, but it's not basic, because they designed those units for native speakers. And you need to develop basic vocabulary for entering and emerging students, and then some required academic vocabulary. So earlier I mentioned for second grade, I will teach paleontologist, and I will teach fossil, and I might teach chisel if I think it's important. And that's not beginner words, but I will then also concentrate on some beginner words like Mary was a lady, was a girl. I will teach dog. I will teach scratch, and maybe some basic vocabulary that happens in the novel or with the fossil. I'll make sure to be teaching bone and mud and clay and so forth. And then for scaffolding, I can use all of the strategies that you see here, many of which we talk about ad nauseum, like sentence frames. But remember that entering kids, they need a word box more than they need a sentence frame. So don't jump into sentence frames too quickly. Although I can use simple sentences where all they supply is one word, a fill-in type of sentence frame. I want to use a lot of objects and realia when I'm teaching fossils. Definitely, I'm going to bring in some fossils. I'm going to use some translanguaging strategies, a lot of photographs and diagrams and graphic organizers. I will explain when we get to the sixth grade unit how to use Prezi's and Padlets and storyboard that. And we'll also talk about some wonderful teacher-produced products that you can access to support these units. So now let's look at the second grade unit. And I did want to mention, if any of you are using ReadyGen, that Mary Anning comes into the fourth grade unit in Unit 1, Module A. So I'm trying to show you all the points of connection, because I know across New York City, a lot of different ELA curriculum is in use. But these, remember, would be my core text. And so one of the things I want to do is I want to see, could I find any home language material to support this learning? And you saw the text, and you know that this text has a higher level of language, so this is going to need more support. This one is still going to use support. So what can I find that might support students? So one of the places I want to go to is worldcatalog.org. Worldcatalog.org is a librarian site, and it shows me all of the editions of published books. It shows me all of the versions and all of the formats of a published book. And my goal is to see if this book exists in other languages. So the first thing that I would do is type the name of the book in the search bar, The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs. And then the book will come up, and then I'm going to click on this link that says view all editions and formats. If I look for this book and I find, it only exists in English, then I'm going to go to book distributors in other languages. And this is where your NYU consultants can be helpful to you, because Lectorum is a book distributor of Spanish books in New York City. And I would go there if I was hunting for Spanish books, either about Mary Anning or to see if maybe The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs has been produced in a Spanish version. But you would ask, what about Russian? What about Haitian Creole? What about Arabic? What about Urdu? Because I know someone is here today that you're working in Urdu. And so we would want to look for all those other languages, Chinese, Japanese, Arabic. What can I find? So when I look up The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs, I am finding other versions, but you can see there's only six editions. And sadly for me, they're only in English. So then I do want you to know that sometimes it will list that the book exists in Braille or or in large print. And believe it or not, sometimes kids like a book better if it's in large print, because it doesn't look so scary and it would have more pages because it's in large print. So think about that too. Like, it might be a version you would want. And just to be sure, I would type in "The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs" plus Spanish or plus Russian or plus Haitian Creole to see, is it going to come up? If I never give up at first search, I search a little bit more just to be certain. But in this case, I lost out and it wasn't in Spanish or any other language. But when I looked for Stone Girl, Bone Girl, I lucked out and I found that it does exist in Arabic. So if I were working with Arabic speakers, I'm in luck, because now I have a native language version of that book that I can offer to my Arabic literate students. And so many of you are working with a multilingual class and you're going to want any language you can find. But in the case of these novels, because it has to do with Mary Anning and is part of a US-based ELA curriculum, the chances are low that you're going to find a lot of translation of these books, but you never give up. Okay, you always take a peek because it doesn't take long. It's worth your effort. Then I would hunt for the fossils books. And when I did that, I found, oh, goody, it does exist in Spanish. And I'm happy because I have a lot of Spanish speakers across New York City. We know that that is the greatest language spoken. And so I also found what I'm calling a fugitive Chinese version, because it wasn't easy to find, but I did eventually find it, how you could order it. And so sometimes you have to, if you know it exists, then the question is finding it and buying it, right? Or giving your kids access to it. But if this is a unit I'm going to teach year after year in the second grade, this is really worth it. And even I know that the kids are going to learn about fossils across the grade, so I definitely want to find books. And I also would see, in addition to the books, the Aliki books, which we saw here, these books are by Aliki. I also look for other books that might exist in Spanish. And when you do that, you're going to search using words from the language you're looking for. So I'm going to not put in fossils and Spanish, because what's going to come up in a Google search is all the translations of the word Spanish. I have to put in the word fósiles, and then books will come up. And I also can go to Amazon España or Amazon Mexico. I can go to the Amazon sites in other countries where Spanish is spoken and see if I can find books at my grade level that will work. This turned out to be a really good one in Spanish when I was hunting. But these books are to prepare kids to build the background that they need to read the books, either about Mary Anning or about fossils. So I'm happy I found this in many languages. And to help all of you, these were the languages that when you signed up, you told me you need or you're using. And I did find, while I didn't find books in Arabic, but don't give up, I think you can. If you know Arabic, you can search in Arabic in ways that I can't, because I don't know Arabic. But I did find videos, and they were developed by teachers and they look good to me from the video portion. I couldn't understand, of course, the audio portion, but they're long. So I did want to mention to you, because later, if you're not using Edpuzzle, I will be showing you Edpuzzle and how you can shorten videos in Edpuzzle. If you have a 24-minute video, you might want to shorten that and just show parts of it. And it is possible to do that in Edpuzzle. I also found an encyclopedia in Chinese about shells and fossils. And again, go there and see if you like it. I did my best, the best that I could, to find materials for you not knowing these languages. And then when I hunted, sadly, for Haitian Creole, I didn't find material already in Haitian Creole about fossils or about Mary Anning. But don't give up. Go ahead and search, those of you that speak Haitian Creole, search a little more. But what I can do in Edpuzzle is take a video that's been created in English, and I can record, I can get rid of the audio that's on it, and I can record using the video portion. I can record in Haitian Creole for my students, a Haitian Creole version. So if I had a 2-minute video, it wouldn't take me long to create a Haitian Creole version. Because remember that video is made up of an audio track and a visual track. So I would use the visual track and I would re-record the audio track in Haitian Creole. And then in Russian, I found a couple videos, check the appropriateness, shorten them if they need to be. I also found a website that was already in Russian, and I found a website in Urdu. And so I was trying to find material that looked to me like it was elementary school material. That's the part you have to check out and see if you think it's appropriate for elementary age learners. But it looked like it was developed by teachers. And when all else fails, I can take visuals and I can record myself about these visuals in the language. So this is going to take a little work, but I might want this for building the background, especially if kids are working remotely some of the time. They need material they can consume at home on their own. And home language listening is possible for everyone, even if they don't read in their native language. So I did find some books in Spanish about Mary Anning, and I would only use certain portions of this. I also found a video in Spanish. So let me show you a bit of this, whoops, a bit of this video. Hello.
Mary Anning nació el 21 de marzo de 1799 en Lyme Regis, Inglaterra. Sus padres, Richard y Molly, pertenecían a un grupo conocido como disidentes. Esto quiere decir que practicaban el protestantismo, pero no seguían la conducta de la iglesia anglicana. El padre de Mary era ebanista, pero también se dedicaba a la búsqueda y comercio de fósiles como complemento para la economía. La familia Anning era pobre y rechazada socialmente por su opción religiosa. Mary Anning no recibió ningún tipo de educación formal, por lo que todo lo que aprendió lo hizo de manera autodidacta y por su propia curiosidad.
Okay, and it continues. So let's say I find a video in the native language and I tried to find for all of your languages. Then the question becomes, oh wait, I'm sorry, let me move on to Bud Not Buddy. I found all of these versions of Bud Not Buddy in other languages. So for the languages that you most need in your districts, Chinese, Japanese, and Spanish, thankfully the novel exists in those languages. And if I needed Italian, Hungarian, Hebrew, German, or Dutch, even Dutch, I might be able to find that book. So I always go to World Catalog, especially when I'm doing a novel or a lengthy book, I might find that book in the native language. And then the question becomes, and how am I going to use it? So one way I could use the home language version, remember this is an ELA class. This is not a science class or a history class. So it's an ELA class. I could use it in place of the English text for students to read if they read on grade level. But it would be better if I had them read some sections in the home language and other sections in English. Or I could have them read at home before they read at school, or use the home language version at school as a support when they're not understanding content, or to add to their enjoyment. Don't forget about enjoyment. Like reading is supposed to be enjoyable, not a chore. So we also want to help them add to their understanding. So when I have a home language text, anytime I'm using translanguaging in an ELA class, I have to say to myself, why am I doing this? How is this helping? How much should I be doing this? When do I need to do this? When should kids do this? And so forth and so on. So all of these are decisions that I can make, but you know from your ENL progressions that New York State wants you to be accessing home language for entering and emerging students. And you can even continue a little bit with transitioning. So we don't want to throw this scaffold away. It's a very, very important scaffold. And I would say to you, the more demanding the text, the more they're going to need some home language scaffolds.
Nancy, may I just bring a question that many of our participants are asking?
Please.
Are these resources free? Would you please address that?
Oh, the World Catalog?
Yes.
Is completely free. It's a website. And remember that on World Catalog, let's just go back there. This is just a place to find books. Once I find this book in Chinese, they're not giving me the book. I have to go buy the book.
Right.
Okay, so, but this is where you're going to turn to your administrators and say, I'm teaching the sixth grade curriculum. We're doing Bud Not Buddy. I need the book in Chinese, Spanish, and Japanese. I found it. Can you please give me $50? When I was a teacher, by the way, these books cost like $8, $7, $6. The fossil books cost around the same. So remember that World Catalog doesn't give you the book. They would be prohibited from that because it's a copyrighted book. You have to buy the book after you find it, but you have to find the book, right? So now the websites, you know, if I find a website, that's free. It's there. So any of these things that I gave you, you're in. Because, you know, the website, the video, there you have it. You don't need to buy anything. It's there for you. But all of you should have ways that you work with your administrators or even your school librarians have access to funds. Now with COVID, there's more funding. But, you know, this has to do with equity, people. Don't forget that. Equitable treatment of learners. And it's not equitable. This was a fight I used to have as a middle school teacher. It's not equitable to give native speakers of English a book in English and then give native speakers of Urdu a book in English. That's not equitable. They need the book in Urdu, if I can find it. And especially if they're entering and emerging, I need to start to bring them into English in a supportive way. So if it's a book, it's a published book, there are funds that are needed. But I found in my school when I was working in San Francisco, the principal has money in that they can use for little purchases. And if you go sometimes that and you show them what you need, they'll give you the money. And it never failed. At the end of the school year, people would come to me and say, I have to spend this budget by tomorrow. Do you need anything? So I always kept a list.
Yes, yes, and yes.
I always kept a list. Keep a list. But if you don't ask, you won't be given. And I really want to encourage you to not spend your own money. Like for those of you that don't know, I worked in New York State for 15 years and I worked on Long Island for 10. And when I was on Long Island, I was at Hofstra University and I did a survey with teachers there. And I found that some teachers were spending as much as $2,500 on their classroom. But at a minimum, a lot of teachers were spending at least $500 because you find the book and then you go, I'm just buying it. And then it's coming out of your pocket. And sometimes you can't get reimbursement. So it's good if you can look ahead. So thank you for asking that question, Maria. A lot is free, but some, if it's copyrighted, you have to purchase it. This is a free site. And you want all of your ELLs, irrespective of language, to know about Word Hippo. Because on Word Hippo, when they're reading, when they run into one word or a short phrase, they can look it up. And even if they don't read, because there's audio, they can hear the word spoken. Now, I can't check the Chinese. So I don't know if this is the best word for fossil, but they always give you more than one word. If there is more than one word, in case you use a different word. Those of you who know Spanish know that a word like kite depends. If you're from Puerto Rico, it's one word. If you're from Mexico, it's another word. If you're from Guatemala, it might be a third word. So sometimes we don't use the same translation for a word. And so this is one where you would want them to be able to see which of these words is right. And when I look up fossil in Haitian Creole, I find it, oh, look at that. It's very similar. Fossil. Okay, so this is good. I can look up words on here that will help me explain things to kids using a word from their native language, and they can use it. This is only useful when they're looking up individual words while they're reading a within reach text or a section of a text. But I did want to mention that every time you see this icon today, I'm trying to show you something that should be in your e-learning toolbox. And definitely Word Hippo is something you should offer your entering and emerging ELLs. So when I'm trying to give comprehensible input, I did find some native language support. I found some Mary Anning books. I found some fossil books in the native language. I found some websites about fossils. Always, if it's informational text, I'm going to find more in the native languages of my kids. When it's a particular novel, then it's questionable if I'm going to find it because it's based on US curriculum. Why should they be using this book in Mexico and translate it to Spanish, or why should they use this in China? You know, so it may or may not exist in other languages. These books are more likely. But then if I can't find a home language version, I'm going to look for adapted or simplified versions. This is a very high Lexile for second graders. It's high second and third grade text. You can see what the text is like without, you know, reading it every word explicitly. And what I can do is hunt for an adapted or simplified version. So this is the same section. Here, it was like three more extensive paragraphs. Here, I have shorter paragraphs, but guess what? They didn't change the vocabulary, so it's still tough. So I have to find these adapted versions, then I have to decide if it's going to work for me or not, but I'm definitely going to look. And I also looked for a very simple book on Mary Anning. It turns out the wording is not very simple. I went to Lexile.com and I typed it in. If you type in a 250 word sample, they'll give you the Lexile, because this book didn't come with a Lexile. And it's a high Lexile. It's as high as the original, 760, and this one's at 800. But what I like about it is it has a lot of visuals. So I can say, this is Mary Anning and her father showed her how to look under rocks and she was on a cliff, and I can show what a cliff is, et cetera. And across the book, I would be able to show a lot of pictures. So as I'm developing the vocabulary that they need around Mary Anning, because remember, I didn't find a lot of simplified versions of these books, I also would look for picture books. And so what step one is to find home language versions, adapted versions, or simplified or illustrated versions. So I'm giving kids comprehensible input. Okay, so that's step one. And and you're going to see that across the different units, I'm going to have different access depending on the language and depending on the text to home language versions, adapted versions, and simplified versions. But I'm on the hunt for them. And I'm teaching this unit for 8 weeks. It's worth my effort to try to find these materials for my kids. Step two is now I have to teach the needed language to them. And I know that they're entering and emerging. So I'm trying to teach them words and phrases and simple sentences. And at the end, I'm going to have them listen to some short video after they know what the text says and they've gotten some comprehensible input and I've taught them some words. Now they're ready for audio. They would not be ready for audio here. Okay, I want to stress that. This is why read aloud. Reading a grade level text aloud to entering and emerging does not change the level of language. If I read But Not Buddy aloud, or I read the dog that dug for dinosaurs, it doesn't change the level of the text, and it's beyond the language level of the student. So when you're suggested to read aloud, remember that it doesn't change it. What your ELLs need, what your entering and emerging students need, is comprehensible input, a simplified text, an adapted text, a home language text to get the input in. Then I'm going to work on teaching them language, the language that they need, and then we will do some listening, okay? Here I can listen in the native language, but I can't be listening in English to grade level text. It's beyond them, okay? So I hope everybody's capturing that point. So the first front loading that I want to do is basic and beginner words. So there's a lot of words in this book, but I have to get it down to the ones that they really need. And so you can see the ones that I picked. And like, if I get these words in, I'll go after some of the other ones. And this phrase, because it's often saying 100 million years ago or 5,000 years ago, XYZ happened. And then there are some content obligatory words that they have to understand, like fossil and mineral and imprint, maybe scientist or maybe paleontologist and maybe track. But this is a lot of words, people. And the vocabulary people tell us that we can only work on 6 to 8 words and really give them a workout. So if I'm after a word, it's not just hear it, I explain it, or they look it up on Word Hippo and then we move on. No, I want these words to be alive in them. I want them to be able to speak stone and rock and become and became and sink and sank and mineral and imprint and fossil. And I want them to be able to write these words. And I want them to do it not because I insist that they do it, but because they've acquired it so well that it's now in their system. Okay, so I will have some what Fred Genesee calls content obligatory words. I can't teach fossils without saying fossil and mineral and imprint and track and so forth. And then I want to find those beginner words. What would be considered beginner words in the book? And so now I want you to hear a video. I think we have time for this before we take the break. This will be the last thing that we're going to do. I want you, not, you already know, I'm sure, two ways that fossils can be created, but I'm going to have you listen to a 2-minute listening activity I would offer the students after I've given them comprehensible input, after I've built background in their native language, after I've taught them some vocabulary. Now I'm going to have them listen to the same text that we've tried to access through the means that we talked about in terms of simplifying the language, explaining what's going on here. Now they are going to listen to the text, but for a specific reason, to listen for two ways that fossils can be created. As you're listening, I want you to see the length of this video. How adequate is this for an entering and emerging student? What about the rate of speech? Are they seeing the print as they're listening? Does the reader take pauses? Because this is the type of video I would want for entering and emerging ELLs.
When the big fish died, it sank into the mud at the bottom of the sea. Slowly, the soft parts of the fish rotted away. Only its hard bones were left. The bones of the fish it had eaten were left too. The skeleton of the fish lay buried and protected deep in the mud. Thousands of years went by. More layers of mud covered the fish. Tons and tons of mud piled up. After a long time, the surface of the earth changed. The sea where the fish was buried dried out. The weight of the layers of mud pressed down. Slowly, the mud turned to rock. As that happened, groundwater seeped through the changing layers of mud. Minerals were dissolved in the water. The water seeped into all the tiny holes in the fish bones. The minerals in the water were left behind in the fish bones. After a very long time, the bones turned to stone. The fish was now a fossil. Some fossils, like the fish, are actual parts of plants or animals that have turned to stone. But sometimes a fossil is only an imprint of a plant or animal. Millions of years ago, a leaf fell off a fern-like plant. It dropped onto the swampy forest soil, which is called peat. The leaf rotted away, but it left the mark of its shape in the peat. The peat, with the imprint of the leaf, hardened. It became a rock called coal. Coal is a fossil too. These are dinosaur tracks. They were made in fresh mud 115 million years ago. Sand filled the dinosaurs' footprints in the mud. The sand hardened into a rock called sandstone. Millions of years later, fossil hunters dug through the rock. They found the fossil tracks, exact imprints of the dinosaur's foot.
Okay, so I'm sorry, there was some background noise there that I don't remember being in the video, but anyway, be that as it may, you could see that this was just several pages of the video. So I shortened this. So it was this spread of 2 pages, this spread of 2 pages, and this spread of, so four pages of a spread. And for many students, for an entering student, that might still be too long, right? So I might have wanted to cut it here and process that part of the text and then show the next 2 pages, 2 open spread pages, and process the next one. You can also shorten videos at this site, onlinevideocutter.com. And so that's another good place for you to know about where you can shorten a video. But this would not be the first time listening to the book. This is after we've looked at this because we've been learning about how fossils are formed. And then I would give them this, but I would never want to exceed more than like 2 minutes of video with entering and emerging students. And 1 minute might already be enough. Even 30 seconds could be enough. But I want the rate of speech to be slow. I want them to see the print while it's being read to them. And I want the reader to take pauses. And so I'm sorry for the background noise, but that reader was reading at an okay rate. So what would I do afterwards? So I do want my kids to have the experience of listening, not just to me, but other speakers, other readers. And so I want some listening activity for them. And after they listen, I would ask them on a give one, get one, to write down two ways that fossils can be creative. So hopefully you understood two ways, like they got the comprehensible input through their native language and adapted versions. We practiced the vocabulary. And then now they got to listen in English to the same sequence of text. And now they're going to give me some output in writing. And here they might give me the home language, one way in the home language with a picture or drawing that fossils can be created. And then maybe some English words and phrases over here. And then a second way. And so they're going to jot down two ways fossils can be created using pictures, their native language, and some short phrases in English. If we're together and we're in person, they can get up and go find a partner, or I'll show you in a minute a way they could do this remotely. They're going to give one idea they wrote down to their partner, and they're going to get one idea. And if their partner gives them an idea they already had, they're just going to put the initials of their partner next to the line of text that they've written. I can also give them phrases. Fossils are made of bone. Fossils are made of imprints. And I could tell them, I want you to use the word impression, or I want you to use the term imprint, or I want you to use the term fossil. So I can put that all into the activity. And then this is just to show you that you can get these templates you can get from the site that I've listed here. But if you want just a very simple template, because you're working with entering and emerging, you just want them to write down one way and get away from their friend, or they're to write down two ways and then go talk to their friend, then you're the one who's going to set this up. And this was not on the form. The form was blank. I added home language, picture, drawing, and English. But this is how I can use the two languages together in an ELA class. Okay, so now we're up against the time that we need to break. So let's go ahead and take a 10-minute break. I'll expect you back at 10:42. And I will start right away at 10:42 because I have a lot more that I want to do with you. But I'll see you then and have a nice little break.
How are you holding up, Nancy?
Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and move forward. I hope that most of you are back. And so where we left off was thinking about how after kids would do a listening activity, then they would do some expressive language. So receiving information through listening after they've done a lot of other work on the topic. And then they would do some simple writing with pictures and possibly using home language and English for their output. But what if they're not together in the classroom? Then how would we do the give one, get one? And I want to show you how, I want you to be thinking about how it might be done if we use Jamboard. Jamboard is a free Google app that you can add if you're using Google Classroom. And those of you that are using Zoom, of course, you do have a whiteboard and your whiteboard would work the same way. But for in case you're not using Jamboard, I want to play just a very short video that tells you what's possible for collaboration among students and with the teacher on the Jamboard. So this is a way that we could work remotely with entering and emerging students.
Hi everyone, this is Annie Schrader here to give you a demo of Google Jamboard. Jamboard is an app that students can download onto their Chromebooks from the Google Play Store. Jamboard is a collaborative digital whiteboard. So there are drawing tools and highlighter tools. They can bring in pictures from the web and clips from the web, but they can also bring in any document from their Google Drive. So I'm going to show you what that looks like over here. I have brought in a Google Slides presentation. So it comes in as this small little icon, and then I can click on it to open it, and then I can scroll through my slides here and I can pull out any slide that I'd like. I can zoom in on it, I can write on it, so I could solve a math problem on it or draw a picture or highlight important information. When I'm done with it, I can minimize it and I can get rid of it or I can save it somewhere on my Jamboard. You can bring out multiple slides if you want or just one. As I said, it's also collaborative, so an entire class could be shared on one Jamboard, all collaborating in real time. So as a student is writing on their touchscreen Chromebook, then the other students would see that writing as it's happening. It can be shared between just a few students, but it also doesn't have to be collaborative. It could be done individually, as I'm doing right now for this demo. There are great tools such as this selection tool that allows you to resize and move your writing. It's great for revising and editing things that you're designing or creating on Jamboard. There are some fun drawing tools. So this is called Auto Draw. It's going to take my tree that I tried to draw there, recognize that I'm trying to draw a tree, and then give me a much nicer tree to use right there. You can bring in clips from the web. So right here, I have snapped a clip from the web, an article about the uses of Google Jamboard in the classroom. So these are just a few things that you can do with Google Jamboard. When I think about how it could be used in a classroom, I always default to how I would use it in a classroom.
Okay, and she goes on to give some examples in math and other subjects of how she would use it. But the reason I'm showing this to you is because when students produce their give one, get one sheet, they could import it, they could bring it in and they could do the sharing there with another student. I can do a lot of collaborative work on Jamboard. I can set up multiple Jamboards so that I could have kids of different proficiency levels working on different Jamboards. You saw that I can import things from the web. And so I could have kind of some native language or home language support if I wanted it right on the Jamboard. So these are addresses that I wanted you to have, that if you'd like to learn more about doing collaborative group work using Jamboard, here's some good places to go. Using it in the Google Classroom, here's a nice video on that. Sometimes you know it can take time to find a good video. This shows how to record with Google Jamboard. And these are two short tutorials that explain how you would use it in your classroom. One is 8 minutes long and the other is 12 minutes long. So hoping that if you're new to Jamboard, that these resources might be useful to you, but you need a technological way to have kids working and collaborating when they're entering and emerging. And Jamboard is a type of technology that is accessible to kids that are new to English. So One of the goals of this unit is for the teacher to ask selected response questions. And so after kids would read multiple times a section of the story, and then they might listen to the same section of the story, we would want to ask questions of them. And remember, I told you earlier, I want you to practice asking a question that an entering student could answer. That would be a question that would allow for nonverbal response, like pointing or showing or circling. I can do that on the Jamboard. Or they could answer in one word or a short phrase. That's what I want from entering. I want to ask a question that can be answered this way. And if they're emerging, I know they could answer in a phrase or a simple sentence. I could use an either or question. I could give them a sentence frame to help them. I could model a response before I ask them to answer. But now what I want to do is to play 2 minutes of the story, imagining that this is like the fifth time they've heard this section. And now I'm going to ask them questions because I've recycled it plenty. So let's take a listen. And after you hear this portion of the story, I'm going to ask you to make one question for an entering student and another question about for an emerging student, but about the part that I'll be playing for you. And while the full video is almost 8 minutes long, I'm just going to play 2 minutes of the video. And I could even shorten it further and just play 1 minute at a time for students. Okay, so take a listen. You're going to make up questions based on what you hear, one for an entering student and one for an emerging student.
Trey and Mary knew that they would find the very best fossils high up on the cliffs around the beach. They climbed up there every day. Trey sniffed the rocks. He pawed the dirt. Mary used a small hammer and chisel. With these tools, Mary carefully cut fossils out of the cliff, just as her father had shown her. Trey watched as she placed the fossils in her basket. Most of them looked like seashells. Mary and Trey sold them as souvenirs to the tourists that came by stagecoach to swim at the beach near their home. One day, Trey and Mary discovered some very large bones sticking out of the rocks. They were huge. Trey growled and tried to dig the bones out. Mary used her hands to brush away the loose dirt. "Trey, we've discovered a monster," she declared. The bones were much too big for Trey and Mary to remove by themselves. "I'll go for help," Mary said. "You stay here, Trey." Trey barked loudly and sat down in front of the bones. He was a very good guard dog. Mary ran all the way back to town and asked some grown-ups to help her. "Trey and I have found something really special in the cliff," she told them. "Just wait and see." When the men saw the giant rib bones in the side of the cliff, they were amazed. "What a beast!" they cried. "Look at those sharp teeth!" "Is it a crocodile?" one man asked. "Or a stubby whale?" "We don't know what it is."
Okay, that's your part. So now, based on what you listened to, and remember, you don't want to ask incidental questions. You want to ask really important detail questions or important main idea questions to your entering and emerging ELLs. They would have accessed this book multiple times, and now this is following the listening activity, and you're going to enter a question into the chat, one for an entering student and one for an emerging student, and label your questions, please. And then I'll have Maria read some of them back to us. Excuse me. So sorry. Okay, so Maria, did you get any questions?
Well, a lot of entering. What tools did Mary use? What did Mary discover? point to the fossils that Mary found, some emerging. Did Mary use a brush or a shovel to uncover fossils? What tools did Mary use to cut out the fossils? What did Mary and Trey find? With a sentence frame, they found blank.
Perfect. That's perfect. Thank you all for playing along. Those are perfect, perfect examples for entering and emerging. And so one of the things that I can do, even when I'm working remotely with kids, is I can create a short video for them, the ways that I've told you so far, either on Edpuzzle or Video Cutter tool on the web that's free. And I can also then give them follow-up questions. And that is a part of Edpuzzle, which I'll be showing you in a minute. But I need to know how to ask those questions so that I'm not exceeding the abilities of entering and emerging ELLs. And it is good if there's pictures, right? Because then I can ask for the pointing, showing, and circling, as was in one of the examples that Maria read aloud. So even if I didn't get to read yours, thank you for playing along. I do look at the chats afterwards, and you all can contact me. I always make sure you have my email if there's a question that you're wanting to ask or you are asking and we never get to it. So another tool for your toolbox, your e-learning toolbox, is Vocaroo. And Vocaroo is a very simple recording device. And this is a place where I could give kids practice asking and answering questions when they're learning remotely. So I would like you to see what Vocaroo is. And you know what, let me get rid of this again. Okay.
Welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I'm going to show you three easy steps on how to use Vocaroo for voice recording. So step number one, how you can use this tool with your English language learners or with any language learners is to go to vocaroo.com. And here your students can record their voices. For example, if you had a speaking task or you had any task requiring students to speak or share their ideas or comment to their partner's answers. So this is one of the alternative ways how you can do it. So your students would go on this website, they will click on the microphone right here, they would record their voice, they would press and stop, and then they click on save and share. A very awesome feature right here that they just copy a link and they can paste it to your Google Classroom or to their comments on Google Classroom, anywhere they want. If they want to download it, absolutely, why not? But here they don't really need to do it, okay? The second option is how you as an educator can use it in your Google Classroom. Here how it goes. I already created a preset for my assignment, for example, speaking practice. And I put that the students need to answer their question and record their voice with vocaroo.com. So here is my question. For my students to hear my question, to listen to what I'm asking them, I also recorded my question and uploaded a link right here with the help of the link. And my students can click on this link and listen to the question, for example. What was something new that you learned last week? Okay, so in the same way, they would click on the website and they will answer the question and paste their link with their recording to their answers. Okay, that was step number two. Step number three, a very useful feature is how you as an educator can embed this tool into the vocabulary model. For example, I have this model for the word analyze, and I can embed my audio from Vocaroo right here because you can insert a link so to anywhere you want. For example, if I want to place a link right here or right here, so I can record my audio with Vocaroo and I can press on link and I can embed my link, for example, in here, and it'll be added. When my students are reading the new vocabulary, they can listen to it as well. All right, I hope that helps. Let me know if you have any questions. Take care.
Okay, so Vocaroo is very simple. You just push the red button and then you copy the link and you can paste it anywhere. And in case it would help your students to hear the directions in Spanish, here is a YouTube video that gives directions in Spanish for how to use Vocaroo. But I would want kids right away to get used to using certain remote tools, those technology tools, because it's going to become a part of classroom life long after COVID is gone, which we hope it will be soon. And I did want you to know that I always want to give kids multiple chances to listen to the same section. I would use a video cutter to shorten it to the same section, but I don't just want them to hear my voice or a female voice. I also want them to hear lots of different voices. So here's a little bit of a male voice.
For it. The Dog That Dug for Dinosaurs by Shirley Ray Redman. A long, long time ago, there was a little dog named Trey. He was black and white all over.
Okay, so there's the same segment that we were looking at earlier, and they can hear it multiple times, but I need to make it interesting. So I'm always looking for different video read alouds, and then I will only select people whose voice is clear and the rate is good, and then I can sequence them in terms of the best and the most accessible one first and so forth. If I only have a few entering and emerging ELLs, I could create a video for them in Edpuzzle. I can take any video that exists and I can shorten it in Edpuzzle. And then I can put the comprehension questions in, the ones that you just modeled, so that I'm not asking everyone in the whole class the same question. I can have different videos that I send the kids to in Edpuzzle. And with very little work, I can have this video, this base video, be the one I'm using for everybody, but I shorten it down for the entering and emerging ELLs. So they're just listening to a segment. And then I ask them questions. There are little stops along the way where I check on their comprehension, but they would be asked in such a way that my entering students could answer. Okay, so Edpuzzle is a very useful tool. And so here are some examples of how I would use Edpuzzle, thinking about my entering and emerging ELLs, all the things I can do with Edpuzzle.
Ever wish you could make a video more relatable to students? You know, just play director so that the video was more relevant to them? Edpuzzle allows you to do just that, giving you the advantage of customizing and personalizing videos to promote active viewing. This free web-based tool allows you to crop, annotate, and remix online videos, whether they're for flipped learning, for independent viewing, or for whole group instruction. First, upload your own video or choose from their vast and vetted library. Then have at it. You can crop and splice together the parts of the video you want your students to focus on. Now let's say you just want to reinforce a key point or further explain an idea. Just add your own voice into the mix with audio notes and voiceovers. Check for understanding and get formative feedback by adding polls or multiple choice questions throughout the video. Give visual cues by adding relevant images. Make a cross-curricular connection by linking to related web content. Draw students in deeper with higher order thinking by asking them to make predictions or add their perspectives by embedding questions. For the optimal viewing experience, Edpuzzle allows you to design customized guidance and support for your students. Other excellent video annotation platforms that support active viewing include Zaption, Educannon, and Vialogs. You know your students and their needs the best. With you in the director's chair, make your students star viewers by personalizing and differentiating videos in just a few clicks.
Okay, so really Edpuzzle is a simple tool and it's free. I know you were asking about that earlier. And I gave you some links up here. Here's a good one on editing videos on Edpuzzle and adding questions and prompts. Make sure that you don't add too many prompts and also make sure that they're level appropriate. And remember I was saying that if I couldn't find any material about fossils or Mary Anning, I can create my own in whatever language I want, as long as I'm proficient in that language or I have access to someone who's proficient in that language. So here are some videos that I found in English about fossils. As you might imagine, there's a ton of them on Edpuzzle. I don't even have to work very hard to find them. Then I just have to find something that's grade appropriate. And if I wanted to find some videos in Spanish, I remember I would type in that language, Los Fósiles. And you can see I found quite a few. Okay, so Los Fósiles Hablan. Los combustibles, fósiles, it's not worded correctly, but anyway, I can hunt and I can find a video and then I can make my own recording, or maybe even better, I can find one that's already done. So now I also gave you this on the Padlet, and it's 3 pages, kind of an overview of what I'm showing you that you can do for entering and emerging students and trying to put it all together. And so I want you to think about the Mary Anning, the dog that dug for dinosaurs, or Stone Girl, Bone Girl. What did you see me have access to? What texts would I have access to? And did you see me showing you? Okay, and we're just trying to remember the things that I was trying to put together. So definitely I have the original version, and I showed you how I would do that in sections. I couldn't find, I only found Stone Girl, Bone Girl in Arabic, but I did find one home language version of that text. Mostly I had to try to find simplified or adapted versions, or for me to find like the picture book about Mary Anning so I could introduce it to them a different way. So I would be looking for as many of these as I could find when I'm planning a unit. And I did talk to you about how we would use home language and English to build background knowledge. We talked about basic vocabulary about fossils and academic vocabulary. And then you saw me try to use different strategies. So I was trying to use, I did mention the use of Realia, like real fossils, the audio and video support, the graphic organizer of give one, get one. I haven't shown you yet storyboard that, Prezi and Padlet. I'll show you that with the next unit. I am going to work on these standards. I will really clarify which of the standards of the unit I'm going to work on wholeheartedly with my entering and emerging students. And then I would have them do a recount task to tell the story of Mary Anning, and they could do it with drawings and a graphic organizer or maybe a storyboard. And then we did practice entering and emerging questions with the dog that dug for dinosaur, just that one section. And also remember that we're trying to use appropriate communicative functions. So then thinking about fossils or fossils tell of long ago. There I found more home language versions. I can definitely do the original version in section with audio support. We could hunt for other topic related picture books in the home language. I would try to use all of these scaffolding methods, that as many as possible. And then you saw with the give one, get one, I had the kids tell 2 ways fossils might be created. And again, I would care about these communicative functions, and you did excellent work there showing how you would ask questions or ask kids to participate in entering and emerging appropriate ways. So this is there on the Padlet just to remind you of the things that I was trying to demonstrate for you in the use of this first unit. And now we're going to move on to the second unit and think about Bud Not Buddy, which of course is far more demanding because it's a 6th grade text, and it's a chapter book, and it has 19 chapters to get through. And so whether I'm doing it with Wit and Wisdom curriculum guide or the expeditionary guide, it's asking quite a lot of the students. And here we can see that it falls in like the 4th or 5th grade range. The 950 is just, remember, this is end of the year where I expect kids to be, but you can see it's in the 4th and 5th grade. And it's a 6th grade text, right? It's used in the 6th grade. And so they do recognize, our Common Core people do recognize, that it's not all about Lexile. We have to look at other aspects that make a text rigorous and demanding. So here's from chapter one. What happens in chapter one is we meet Bud. For those of you that don't know the story, he's in a foster home, an orphanage, and he and another boy have gotten lucky and they're going to be sent to foster homes instead of living in the orphanage. And so one of the people working in the home comes to tell them, the social worker comes to tell them, guess what, you're going to go to a foster home. And then Bud and Jerry, the two boys, start talking about making guesses of where they might go. And we actually see Bud then pack his suitcase, and then we come to find out the special things that he's saving in his suitcase that become very important across the text. So I want you to look at this text, and I want you to think, who can handle this text? Entering, emerging, transitioning, or expanding? What do you think about this text? You can see some of the language here. Here's some more. This is the length of one chapter. It's like 7 pages long. So it's not long chapters, but look at the language. Certainly not entering text. It's not emerging text. What would you say?
You're all coming in expanding.
Yes, and you're exactly right. So now if I'm going to use this, this is a lot further away, people, isn't it? If I'm going to try to get them to do any reading of this text in English, I'm going to have to really think about how to do it. But before I leave the chapter, I wanted to show you that the front loading for this chapter I would work on beginner words. And even though this is an old fashioned word, glum, instead of sad, I have to teach it because it's the word used in the text. And I would be teaching very simple beginner words that come up in this text before they would ever see the text, so that at least they recognize who the characters are, that there are two boys and they're going to go to a foster family and they're in an orphanage. They never use the word orphanage. It just says home. They're in a home and they're sitting on their bed and they have breakfast and they pack up their suitcases. Okay, so all of that happens in this text, but I'm going to focus on that. I'm not going to focus on other more demanding words that are coming up here, like leaning against him or lamppost. I mean, commence. No, I'm not going to go there. I'm going to work on the beginner words because I'm trying to do level appropriate vocabulary development for my entering and emerging students. But I will have to build background before we enter this chapter about orphans and group homes and foster families and what flyers are, because that features heavily in the story. He has a flyer that his mother saved and was special to her, and it's all about jazz musicians. So what am I going to do with entering and emerging ELLs? Well, I'm going to have to find simpler text. And so one of the things that I might do is find something like this, a summary, a simplified version of the knowledge of the novel, excuse me, that I can use as a preview. Like if I am going to read chapter one, and by the way, you have to read some of the chapters, do a close read of some of the chapters. So there's 19 chapters and I have to decide how many of these might I read. And let's say I'm going to do 3 or 4 of them. It's going to be a lot of work to get through a chapter like this with entering and emerging students. And they won't know every word when I'm done. I just want them to understand the main actions and events that take place in the chapter and build some language. But to get them started at all, I might have to use a chapter summary like this that I found on Teachers Pay Teachers. It's a whole simplified version of the novel where it just summarizes the events. And by reading this ahead as a preview, they will have a better understanding of the chapter. So we could read it ahead as a preview. Then we could read, even I could decide just, I could get rid of some of the parts of chapter one. We could only read certain sections that I identify. I could black out or white out certain paragraphs because they're not that central. It's going to take a lot to get through the ones that are left. And then I could come back to this, make sure that everybody got this as kind of a review. So here it is. Bud Caldwell, the main character, lives in an orphanage. He's 10 years old. A caseworker tells him they found a temporary home. This is the third foster home he's gone to. His mother died when he was 6. And so now they're doing some background building too, talking about the depression and that he keeps a suitcase. So they're giving the key things that you want kids to know after they've read chapter one. And here on this simplified version, I have that much is explained to me. But another chapter that I found was a 33-page support for chapter 6, and it was from Read 180. And you can see that unlike the novel itself, where there's just zero pictures, this Read 180 version gives me illustrations. It explains who the characters are. It explains a bit about the plot. And of course, I can't show you all 33 pages, but you can see the type of support that is given when they're reading the chapter. So knowing that this exists, I would make chapter 6 one of the chapters that I'm going to do a close read of. In other words, I'm going to approach this novel with entering and emerging students as some close reads of a smaller number of chapters that are important to the plot of the story. Chapter 1 is very important. It introduces the main character, the setting, and the beginning of the plot. Chapter 6 is also an important chapter, so I'm thrilled that it exists in this version. And I basically would be hunting for any of these that would allow me to do a close read with my entering and emerging students. Some alternate materials that we found, remember, I found all those home language editions. There's Universal Design for Learning has a site called Book Builder. And this is a very, they offer simplified versions of some books. Teachingbooks.net is a site you could go to. And many, many books that you teach are on there with all the many, many supports that have been developed. In this case, there is a dramatic version of Bud Not Buddy. And that would be a great way for me to work, to provide kids with a play version of the chapter where they could see the events take place in a play format. And I would always be looking for simplified and summary versions to supplement the reading, the close reading that we're gonna do. And I can also look for things like book trailers where they do a summary of what happens in the novel. But remember that with entering and emerging students, they need either a dual language version, a predictable version, or a version that has strong illustrations, photographs, drawings, and models. So I might have to create a PowerPoint to go along with the chapter that gives them visuals to support the reading. And so I have to think about what is it that the students will need to gain access to this, given that it's a sixth grade on grade level text and they are entering and emerging. When they get to the emerging level, we can do guided reading and shared reading, but read aloud is still not going to get any closer unless I've done some processing ahead. So you do have to get through the text. Remember, comprehensible input is going to be home language versions, adapted versions, visually supported versions, and so forth. And then they can listen to the audio versions once they've had access to the chapter. So got to teach that background knowledge and key vocabulary. So some of the front loading that we could do here would be, we might want to create a map that shows where the story takes place, and it mostly takes place. Of course, this is just a portion of the United States. It doesn't show them where Michigan is, but you know that one of the challenges for English learners is they don't know Michigan. Why would they? They're entering and emerging. They're just starting English, which probably means they're new arrivals if they're in the sixth grade. So we have to show maps. We have to show where this is taking place. And then I'm going to need a lot of photographs to show them what life was like during the Great Depression. This is where Wit and Wisdom has some advantages over expeditionary learning because they do automatically include a lot of photographs. But it's not hard to find photographs about the Great Depression. So I would want to show people being out of work and people needing to go to soup kitchens and things like that. And then because it happens in the story, I would have to show what a Hooverville is. I would have to explain who Hoover was, President Hoover, why it was called Hooverville, and make them really, really understand these shanty towns. And then I would have to help them understand group homes and orphanages and how kids had to live if they were orphaned and something happened to one or both of their parents. So all of this would be front loading that I would need to do for this novel. They wouldn't even see chapter one until I would do a lot of this front loading, because how are they going to understand this novel if they don't understand the background? The other part of front loading, as you well know, is finding the words to teach. And here I'm thinking about three things: the frequency of a word appearing, suitcase appears a lot, and so do the names of people, and also describing woman, man, boy, so forth. All those family words are important across the story. I would have to find those words that really matter a lot as we work. And so I would try to find the words that refer to an essential concept or are likely to appear frequently or are found frequently and are useful in the text. Once I decide on my words, and you need to keep the number of words small, then I remember I'm choosing good words for beginners. What might some of those words be? Well, I might have to teach all of these people words. I might have to teach foster family, foster home, pack a suitcase, paper, picture, flyer, jazz, jazz musician, runaway, escape, hunt for his father. This is all language that's important. And once I decide it's important and it's conceptual, having to do with the story, then I can create a foldable. Foldables are very, very useful tools for English learners that are at the entering and emerging level, because I'm just including the word and behind it a short definition. Okay, so be thinking about foldables. I gave you a link to that. This is Dina Zeich. Dina Zeich created, she's got a gazillion foldables, but foldables are very useful for learning new vocabulary. And once kids write words down, they can quiz themselves and they can quiz one another. So they can have, and by the way, they could use home language too as a support, but remember that we want to get them into English because they're now in the ELA class. So let's talk about how I could give them some practice. Once I decide that suitcase is important, and they certainly need to know the name Bud because that's the main character. And maybe I want them to be able to describe, not just know nouns, but also some adjectives for describing the library, the Amos's shed, Deesa Malone, who he meets, Lefty Lewis, who he meets, or Hoovervilles, those crowded, dirty place filled with simple shacks that are falling down, made of cardboard and sticks. They might be describing any of these. If I want them to be able to say old suitcase, large suitcase, leather suitcase, Bud's old, large leather suitcase, these are ways that I can start building language in students using not just nouns, but also descriptive words. And so now I'm going to show you a bit about seesaw, because then I'm going to show you how I use seesaw to work on describing Bud's suitcase. Okay, so let's just hear a piece about seesaw and what it can do in case you're not using it. I highly recommend seesaw over Flipgrid for entering and emerging students because it's simpler. It's simpler to use, almost as simple as Vocaroo.
Hi students, welcome back to Seesaw. This video will show you all how to use the microphone button within your Seesaw Canvas. So if you go over to the left here, you have four buttons. 1, 2, 3, 4. If your directions ask you to record yourself speaking, you're going to choose the microphone button. It is the second button on the left. When you choose the microphone button, be prepared to answer the question your teacher has asked you. The question here is, what was your favorite part of the book? When I'm ready with my answer, I will click on the microphone button and it will count down for me. 3, 2, 1, go. Now I can start speaking and sharing what my favorite part of the book was. If I need a second to pause and think some more, I can go back over to the left and click on this red pause button. If I'm done recording what I'd like and I'm happy with what I have shared, I can come all the way up to the right where you see this green button that says done. If I'm happy with what I recorded, I will press here. I can play back my recording to make sure that it's exactly what I want by pressing the play button here. Now I can start speaking and sharing what my... If I'm happy with it, I want to turn it into my teacher. I'll do that by coming back up to the right corner and pressing the green check mark. This green check mark will submit my work to my teacher. Thank you for watching.
OK, Okay, so you can see it's very simple. They just click on the microphone, they do their recording. If they like it, they click done, and then they click check mark, and off it goes to their teacher. And so we can use Seesaw with Google Classroom or really anything. They can import drawings, photographs, videos. They can upload material. It's very, very useful. Vocaroo only records audio, but you can see that Seesaw does lots of things that will be useful with entering and emerging students. So I highly recommend it to you as something that you might choose. And so I wanted to show you, and I gave you a QR code and a short link that we'll put into the chat box right now. I created in my activity library, Seesaw is free. And in my activity library, I created an activity for describing Bud's suitcase. And so here I was able to, first I was able to give them some words, and for each word that's there, I was able to record it, and they could click on this little speaker that's next to each word. They could hear me say games and blanket and flyers and old and new and worn out and raggedy and wrapped in twine. And I also recorded some sentences. Bud's suitcase was old, Bud's suitcase was wrapped in twine. And then I could give them my directions already recorded. You can hear all of this if you go to the Seesaw. And then I gave them a template that they could pull up. They could write some phrases or some words. They could write a couple sentences describing Bud's suitcase, and then they could record. So I can have them listen, I can have them speak, I can have them write, and I can have them submit, all through by creating this activity for my entering and emerging students. And this gets them beyond a single word level, because now they're saying Bud's old raggedy suitcase, okay? Or as many as they can pack together. They're starting to see how English works by putting this all together, okay? And I think kids enjoy Seesaw, so be thinking about this, but I wanted to model for you how I could work it into something that I'm doing with Bud Not Buddy. Because again, the suitcase is critical. He keeps it with him everywhere. It's his home, really, his home away from home. And the things that he cares most about are in that suitcase. And some of your kids have had experiences like that too, that they have just a few belongings that they were able to bring, maybe as refugees. Those belongings really mean a lot to them. So this is a book that would really resonate with many of our learners. Okay, so I showed you all three parts of this. So if you need Seesaw instructions of other languages for students or for parents, I did find instructions about Seesaw in Chinese and in Spanish. And you and the student's parents can use Seesaw. You can use a translation tool to communicate with one another, but I don't know why this would be so, but you can't use it with students. It's only between parents and teachers. But there's a lot on Seesaw of value to you. So another e-learning tool that I could use is Storyboard That. Some of you know about Storyboard That. There is a version of Bud Not Buddy already there on Storyboard That. So it's free, and I can search on Storyboard That, and I can see if any material exists that explains Bud Not Buddy. And I did find one that explained the characters, the theme, the cause and effect, and so forth. But I do want to point out to you that Storyboard That is very primitive in terms of the visuals, and is this really the image that we want them to have in their head of this story? So obviously the Read 180 visuals are hands and feet above the visuals that you're gonna get in Storyboard That. But this is a place where kids could tell you their understanding of chapter 1 or chapter 6 or chapter 19. So they could create panels like this, where they pull in the figures and the setting. And then with very little language, they can write what's going on. And so kids could work on this together. They could do this on a Jamboard. They could do this on Seesaw working together. So remember that if we're doing this remotely, I can combine things like Storyboard That with Vocaroo, with Seesaw. I can put a couple things together. But here they could learn more about the character, the theme, the plot, the rising action, the falling action, the resolution, if you're teaching that. But Storyboard That, the best part of it would be not so much that they would read from there. I'd rather have them read other places this is not the best way to learn about the novel, but it is a place where they could produce output for me. They could create a summary of a section of a chapter, a few chapters, or a section of the novel or the novel itself. Another way that they could summarize is with Prezi. And I found 137 Prezis that were student created that were timelines of the complete novel, Bud Not Buddy, of what happened at the beginning, what happened at the middle, what happened at the end. Your students could also create Prezi timelines because you can see that they don't need a lot of words and they can import pictures and illustrations and visuals into a Prezi. So a Prezi is a simple, simple tool. It's free, and it should be part of your e-learning toolbox with your entering and emerging students, and a very accessible type of activity that you could do on a Prezi would be a timeline. Okay, so you can get ideas for how to put timelines together. They're of all different levels of language. This was a simple one, which is why I'm modeling with that one. So if you wanted them to do a timeline project, you could do it on storyboard that. They could tell what happened at the beginning, middle, and end. They could tell the rising events and the falling events and the climax. But you don't want students to just be consumers of Prezis or storyboard that. You want them to produce these. And so you want them to learn how to use it and then maybe choose 6 to 12 events that they're going to put on their timeline or in the storyboard that, and then they'll submit that as a project. But it is a way that they're summarizing main idea and key details, right? So it is fitting with my standards. Or they could just describe the suitcase like I showed you earlier. So these are different ways that we could work. And I showed you the source of this project. So I found this project in Teachers Pay Teachers. I'm not promoting that you spend money. There are a lot of free things on Teachers Pay Teachers. And sometimes I can see an activity without buying anything and then modify it for my students. I could also use Padlet. I could use Padlet for a map. And I could show exactly in North America where Michigan is and then dig into where Flint is and where Grand Rapids is, because that's where the story takes place. Or I could have them do a timeline as a Padlet. And kids can collaborate in Padlet as well. So when you go to Padlet, you'll get lots of ideas. We used the Padlet today to give you the handouts. So we loaded them like this on a wall or in a shelf. And you can use all sorts of Padlets with your students. You could use it for a vocabulary notebook and so forth. But in Padlet, you're not able to record. That's why you need Seesaw, that you want them to hear the word, not just see the word. So I would eventually have them listening to audiobooks and read alouds, but only once they understand the events in the story, because I want them to hear. I want them to have to listen to English, and I want them to listen to grade level English, because when they get into their statewide assessments, nobody's going to give them entering text. They're going to have grade level text. So I want them to be exposed to grade level text, but in small doses. So I'm going to give them like a 2-minute clip. In this particular one, this full video is 11 minutes. I chose just 2 minutes of it. And it starts with comprehension questions, which I could ask before and after they listen. But remember that the reason I want you to hear this is to hear how I would hunt for a dramatic read aloud. So
Bud Not Buddy. Chapter 1. Here we go again. We were all standing in line, waiting for breakfast. One of the caseworkers came in and tap, tap, tap down the line. Uh-oh. This meant bad news. Either they'd found a foster home for somebody, or somebody was about to get paddled. All the kids watched the woman as she moved along the line, her high-heeled shoes sounding like little firecrackers going off on the wooden floor. Shoot. She stopped at me and said, "Are you Buddy Caldwell?" I said, "It's Bud, Not Buddy, ma'am. She put her hand on my shoulder and took me out of line. Then she pulled Jerry, one of the little boys, over. Aren't you Jerry Clark? He nodded. Boys, good news. Now that the school year has ended, you both have been accepted in new temporary care homes starting this afternoon. Jerry asked the same thing I was thinking. Together? She said, why no?
Okay, so you can see I picked a segment that I thought was important. They can listen to it multiple times. I can assign it to them on Seesaw or Vocaroo to listen to multiple times. So all of the tools that I've shown you earlier are useful. And then I can ask them comprehension questions. If I import it into Edpuzzle, I can do everything there. Okay, so these are all options. So I do want to show you ways that if it's not already recorded, they could listen to a recording. And so let's say a chapter is not recorded anywhere and I want them to hear it. They could hear it using Google Chrome Read and Write. So let me show you that.
Google apps for education are everywhere. You might well be using them in your own school, along with millions of other students and teachers. Google Apps are great, but what about students who need a little extra help? Working with documents and the web can be a challenge for struggling readers and writers, English language learners, and students with learning disabilities like dyslexia. Now there's an answer to help every student get the most from Google. Take a look. Read and Write for Google Chrome is this friendly toolbar that installs neatly in your Chrome web browser. So it plays nicely with all these classroom devices, PCs, Macs, and Chromebooks too. It's there whenever it's needed, making it easier for students to work with Google Docs and other documents like PDFs or EPUBs. It also works with web pages. Okay, let's see how easy it is to use. Highlight any passage of text and hear it read out loud. You can pick different voices and adjust reading speed to suit any listener. Speech to text accurately transcribes your students' words as they talk. It's ideal for capturing thoughts on the fly, especially for people who find typing tricky. Word prediction helps reluctant writers, offering word suggestions as you type. There's a talking dictionary, picture dictionary, and fact finder that make research faster, easier, and more fun. And there's a translator for other languages, such as French and Spanish. These colored highlighters are really useful for collecting and summarizing key information. Just pick out key points and gather them together in a new document. Why not try Read and Write for Google Chrome today? It's already being used by millions of students worldwide, and you can install it free at the Chrome Web Store.
So one of the things that I could do here is I could import just one passage that's very critical, that having from chapter one or chapter six or whatever chapter, and the kids could listen to it multiple times, and then we could work on it together to make sure that they're really understanding. Or I could build background knowledge and vocabulary for that section, then we could really dig into that section and find evidence and the kinds of things that we want sixth graders to do. So another tool, and I'm not going to play this for you, but if you watch this video, you'll be able to see Immersive Reader, which is another option if you're not using Google Classroom. And Immersive Reader is included in Nearpod if you're using Nearpod, and it also exists independently for any Microsoft product. And it is another read aloud tool, and you can also slow down in both of these platforms. You can slow down the reading for kids. So in Google Read and Write or in Immersive Reader, you can have it played more slowly without sounding odd to the student. So one of the things that one of you asked before today was you wondered about plot diagrams, and because it's a strategy that's mentioned in the ENL progressions. And I wanted to show you two plot diagrams in case you're not using them. This one is a very simple one that I might use with entering and emerging students. And it just lets the kids write what happened in the introduction, what was the rising action, what was the climax, what was the falling action, and what was the resolution. Or here, if they're high emerging, low transitioning, they might write a little more. But these are both examples of plot diagrams, and they are very useful for entering and emerging students, and they are recommended in the ENL progressions for your use with entering and emerging students. And I gave you the links to these documents should you want to use these exact ones. But I also found this one, which is very attractive. It's free. It was on Teachers Pay Teachers, but it's free. And here it has nice illustrations that go along with Bud, Not Buddy. And so this involves more times, more events that take place in the story. And they do give you a teacher key to make sure you know what should be on each of them. But this is kind of an attractive way that you might do. They're calling it a story arc, but it is a plot diagram, a plot graph. I also want to get into my units and try to find material that's already there that I can use with entering and emerging kids. I don't have all the minutes in the world. You know how tired you are from trying to make everything happen. So as much as I can find in the original unit that could be used with entering and emerging kids, I want to use it. And I did find this one in the expeditionary learning unit. And all the kids have to write is what I know about Bud and how I know it. So this could be bullets. It could be a bulleted list. I could do it with a partner, a writing partner. I could write in the home language and then I could write below in English. And so here at this Weebly, they're introducing, at this particular Weebly, they introduce the characters. This page is from a student journal from this unit. So I don't want to confuse you. What's on the left-hand side is from a Weebly that a teacher created. What's on the right-hand side is direct from expeditionary learning. And on that same Weebly, they talk about setting, plot, conflicts, point of view, and themes. So it's a very useful Weebly for you to return to as you're planning the unit to make sure you get these main ideas across to your students. Now, how would you work on this with entering and emerging students? Again, we can go back to foldables and we could use this layered lookbook. And one line could say characters, the next could say setting, the next could say plot, the next could say character traits of Bud, the best part, the worst part. You are deciding on the labels, but this is a good approach with entering and emerging because it requires only words and phrases or simple sentences. Okay, so if I were to take these ideas from the Weebly, and if I were to not use expeditionary learning tools, I could get the same ideas across to my entering and emerging students by using a foldable. And this is transportable. Kids can take it. And if they're going to have a quiz on Bud Not Buddy, they would have access to this and they could study at home and so forth. So, now I want to talk about the kinds of metacognitive reading strategies we want to teach entering and emerging ELLs, because we want our ELLs to become more strategic right from the start when they're first entering English. And I've shown this table to you if you've been to other PDs that we've offered, that I've been a part of. I've shown this table to you before. This is the source of it. These are all the metacognitive strategies ELLs need. But now I want to focus in on the ones that beginners can use. So before I ever show them the novel or we look at the novel, I've marked some of the global reading strategies I think I could easily teach to entering and emerging kids. And I'd like you to think of the six that I've marked, which would you choose before they've read a word? They don't know anything about this novel. I want to stress that. They've not seen anything about it. They know nothing. I haven't done any front loading, but they're about to read this novel. What would be the best global reading strategies that I could use before I enter it? And I'm going to show you another strategy, which is to play music while they work to keep their energy up and give them a feeling of the time. So as you decide which of these six you think would be good before I introduce the novel, I'm going to play some music.
What da do, da da do, da da do.
Okay, Okay, so you might recognize that music, but we want to do things like this while we're in the unit to give the kids a feeling of the period of time, but also to keep their energy up and get them engaged and block the silence while they're thinking or working. So in this case, I've asked you which of these you think would be best. And so what do you think? Which of those do you think would be best? Put it in the chat.
So far, activating prior knowledge is coming up, predicting, activating, setting the patterns.
Yep. And so the ones that wouldn't fit well, I'm agreeing with you, is using text features. What text features? There are none. Sometimes things that are in here, I could teach it, but it won't be helpful. So we want to be thinking about which we're going to teach and why we're teaching it. And so when we set a purpose for reading or we activate prior knowledge, the things that you just...
Connections there, activating prior knowledge and also making connections with their own experiences, which is like prior knowledge.
Yeah, well, making personal connections is a little bit different. It's not on the list, but it's a good one. Mm-hmm. Okay, so definitely that's perfect. But I wanted to show you that some of the things that exist for this unit. This was a journal entry that was created on this website. And so here I could just show them book covers, the various book covers that have existed and say, in what time period do you think this story takes place? Who do you think the main character is? Why is there a band on the cover? Why is he holding a suitcase? And we can make some of our guesses just based on pictures, and that would work well for entering and emerging students, just showing the covers. And then once we start reading, whether we're reading the synopsis version or we're reading sections of a chapter, that once I get started, then I can predict what I think is going to happen in the next chapter and so forth. And this is, again, I always give you the source where I got this from. So which of the problem solving strategies would you teach with this text? You saw the demand of this text. What do you think would work? We getting anything, Maria?
Yeah. Visualizing the text. A lot of visualizing is coming in now. Thanks, guys. Close attention to reading.
Yeah.
Visualizing again. Visualizing is rereading. That's always good.
Yeah. So yeah, pausing to reflect on reading, adjusting your reading rate, reading slowly and carefully, and so forth. All of those are good. And visualizing too, if they're getting enough comprehension, right? Oh, visualize. Sorry, Maria?
Visualizing and rereading.
Yeah, and rereading, but reading out loud is not going to help an entering or emerging student because they're not sure if they're reading it correctly, right? Oh. So rereading is good, but reading out loud, maybe not so much. Mm-hmm. This is again, something from wit and wisdom that I could use. And here, if kids were pausing to reflect on the reading, they could write three words that describe Bud, two questions that they have about Bud. They could do that in home language or English. And one event that revealed the most about Bud's character. Again, if they can't do it in English, they can share in their home language. So this is like what happened in chapter one when Bud's mother died when he was 4. What was his reaction? What does this reveal about his character? I'm looking for simple templates from my curriculum that I might be able to use. And so a final list of things that I might do is taking notes in the native language or English, discussing the reading in the home language with same language partners, asking myself questions. These are all things I want to teach entering and emerging kids right from the beginning. And this is where I might then have them use a graphic organizer for taking notes, where they're going to compare the night in the shed. I know if you've never read this book, you don't know about the shed. He spends a horrible night in the Amos's shed because he's being punished. And then he spends a delightful night in a bedroom that turns out to be his own mother's bedroom, only he doesn't know it when he's sleeping there. He thinks it's just a little girl's bedroom at the end of the novel when he does find his father. So they would compare and contrast his experience with, and again, single word is fine, phrases are fine, simple sentences are fine, and I can use it. It's straight from the unit and very usable on my part. So we all know how helpful graphic organizers are. I've given you a bunch of links. The Houghton Mifflin that used to be at EduPlace is now at the Houghton Mifflin site. Unfortunately, I don't think they have the Spanish versions of these available anymore, but also at Holt, you can find more of these. And remember, we want to match the graphic organizer to the text structure. So if I'm looking at event one, event two, event three, event four, I want a graphic organizer that lets me capture that flow or that sequence. Okay, it should match. And I can use the graphic organizer while I'm reading, and then I can use it later for speaking or for writing. And because the EduPlace no longer has the Spanish, I wanted to remind you, for those of you that might need the Spanish, that there are graphic organizers in Spanish already ready to go at reading A to Z. And this could be useful talking about the beginning of the chapter, the middle of the chapter, the end of the chapter, whether we're doing second grade or sixth grade. We all know about sentence frames, but you need to have the sentence frame match the proficiency of the learner. So on this slide, I tried to show some that could work for entering and emerging students. Remember that I'm going to use less of this, of the framing with entering, because they should just be giving me words and phrases. And I did put on the Padlet this longer document that shows by standard some phrases for beginners, intermediate, and advanced. So entering and emerging, transitioning, expanding, and commanding. And never mind it's for fourth grade, because you know that this standard 4.1 is pretty much the same across all the grade levels. So never mind this says it's for fourth graders. I think you could use this at any grade level, and you might have to make the sentence frames for entering and emerging even simpler than the ones that they model here. But take a look at that chart later on. Oh, and I did want to mention, because it's on the lesson plans, bounce cards are on EL success form. Bounce cards are just jumping in phrases that they could use for a discussion, but they're very similar to sentence frames. So the final thing we want to look at, we're almost there. Remember that entering and emerging students can only draw and label and write phrases and simple sentences, and they need supports. They can use drawings. They can complete graphic organizers. They need models and sentence frames to support them, word boxes for support. All of this we're going to offer to them. But some kinds of writing that they could do is just making a list of setbacks and challenges that Bud had in the book. So every time they see another setback or challenge, they can just write it down, and that will help them at the end to summarize. And they could use a T-chart. So I wanted to remind you what a T-chart is. So they could write a setback or a challenge. They could write home language and English, however you set up the T-chart. They could make a timeline. We talked about that enough. They could make a poster advertising why Bud would be a great kid to adopt, what are his strong points, and so forth. They could write a letter to a friend telling him or her about the novel and why you liked it and why you think they should read it. They could write another ending, a sequel, a mini sequel. What if you didn't like the way it ended, what would happen in the next chapter? And here, the way that they would do this, they would use bullets to outline the events that happen next. They would turn the bullets into simple sentences, and they would write the three sentences together as a short paragraph. Or they could write down what they would pack in their suitcase if they could only carry what they could fit inside. And it could be a list or it could be simple sentences. So these were just some ideas. Remember that we want to have writing tasks for our entering and emerging, but they might be different. It's not going to be a big old essay like we're going to get out of transitioning and above. We're going to have to create different types of writing activities, but still get at the same goals of the writing standards that have been set for this unit. So here's another idea that I got from a teacher, which is life is a series of doors. What door closed for Buddy and what door opened? I added this lined paper down here, and you could do that too. So we could create a template where there are doors. They have to write what happened, what door closed, and then either put some phrases down here, some bullets, some words, or some simple sentences telling what happened. His mother died, so that door closed. He couldn't be with his mother anymore. And what door opened? Well, we want to think of a positive door, which the foster home, or maybe it's a partially positive thing, but the orphanage was not. And then eventually he finds his family, that door opens. He finds his father, his grandfather, actually. So in putting this one all together, the third page of this handout that was on the Padlet shows you the things that I found. So I want you to think now, what did I find for Bud Not Buddy? What did you see me finding in terms of text for input? Think about as many check marks as you could put. What did you see me find? Certainly, I always find the original version.
Pictures. Somebody's saying pictures already. Summaries.
I found summaries.
Home language versions.
I found home language versions. I didn't find any picture books, although Read 180 kind of came close to it for that one chapter. And then I would have to decide on vocabulary for beginners. I will not take words from that they tell me. Now this is, don't let anyone know I said this, but I get the unit for sixth graders and they tell me what vocabulary to work on, but it's so beyond entering and emerging students. I only want to take words from their lists that I feel are conceptual, that are academic words that I feel that the student needs. I can't be working at that level yet. My beginners need beginner words and I need to work on the background knowledge, right? So what did you see me find for scaffolding? Between the Prezi and the storyboard that, and what I can do on Seesaw and what I can do with Vocaroo.
Graphic organizers.
Definitely.
Almost all of them. Illustrations, sentence frames.
Sentence frames, definitely.
Vocabulary.
Yep, and that's back over here.
Images.
A lot of images. Remember, I showed a lot of photographs from the time. It's not listed there, but I did play some music from the time to try to give them a feeling. And I know that was just one audio file, but use of music that really mirrors some aspect of the text is a good thing to do in the background while kids are writing, while they're thinking. It just fills the space and it gives them kind of cover while they're working.
That was highlighted by our participants when you were doing this. It doesn't mean a thing if you ain't got the swing.
Yeah. So if any of you do swing dance, you probably wanted to get up and dance.
Yes, I should
have. Yeah. So, but it is kind of fun, right? So I really do need them to understand Hoovervilles. That's really critical for this time. And also, you know, people being living in homes and eating in food kitchens and having to sleep in just on the ground. And that happens across the novel. These would be my honest to God standards that I would be working on. And then you saw that I would have them summarize a chapter. You saw me do that with the Venn diagram where they compare and contrast Bud's night, or maybe they'll make a list of his setbacks, or maybe they'll summarize a chapter with a timeline and listing the events. And then don't forget that I need to access my communicative functions and my leveled questions. So this is really important, people. I can't stress it enough. This is how I'm going to engage them. This is what I should be asking them to do, whether it's on Seesaw or Jamboard or Vocaroo or Nearpod or somewhere else, whatever you're using. I want to remember the communicative functions that I'm after with entering and emerging and how to ask my questions. But you're experts at this. I probably didn't need to give you that activity at all. It was just a little reminder because you wrote beautiful questions. So let's just move to the resources now that I've collected for you and wrap up. So one of the things that I found that Syracuse City Schools did is really quite nice. They did this in the winter of 2017. It's a chart and they did this. It has more pages. They have a page like this for every proficiency level. They give the definition of the proficiency level and what kids can do, the New York State Education Department definition. They tell the student behaviors associated with it, what kids need, the challenges kids have, including social emotional challenges, which is important, and the teaching strategies that we should be using. So I think you probably will want to download this. These are the learning tools that I showed you today. I showed you Jamboard, but you could replace that with Zoom Whiteboard if you're using Zoom. I showed you Vocaroo, Seesaw, Edpuzzle, Storyboard That, Prezi, Padlet, Immersive Reader, and Google Read and Write. These are the tools that I think are very useful and accessible to entering and emerging kids. They're not complicated. I can teach an entering and emerging kid to do it. And especially if I can use their native language, I know I can teach them how to use these tools. If any of you would be interested, I found a nice video with secondary students on using secondary frames. It's on Colerain, Colorado, but it gave me a chance to remind you there's wonderful, wonderful resources that you can collect from Colerain, Colorado. I also found a couple videos, one that's 18 minutes long showing you all the features of Google Read and Write, and a short one if you don't have a lot of time, but you'd still like to know how to use it because you're using Google Classroom. And then this summary table shows you all of the ways that they can use the write, you know, mostly I showed you the read part, things being read aloud, but they can also use it for writing. And these are all the tools that exist in Google Read and Write that can support kids when they're trying to write in English, the picture dictionary, the translation, and so forth. And so that's it. Now we would like to give a few minutes to like some open questions that you have. Also, we want to explain to you about the credits.
Okay, Nancy, I have one that has come up several times and I'll just read it. Our participants would like any kind of a highly recommended professional book on biliteracy. We know you don't promote a particular one, and we understand that, but can you recommend a teacher resource book around biliteracy? That was the
question. Well, I really like the one that was written by Cheryl Uru, and now I'm blanking, but it's by Caslon Press, and if you send me a little email, I'll send you the full title, but it has biliteracy in the title, and it's Caslon Press. And if you put in biliteracy in Amazon with Cheryl Uru and Karen Beeman, I just thought of her name, Karen Beeman and Cheryl Uru, and biliteracy in Amazon with the name Caslon, because that's their publisher, it'll come right up. And it shows how to work across the two languages. But if you're trying to think about how to introduce reading in the two languages or how to use both languages?
Like them to say that out loud, or I'm not sure how you want to handle that.
Okay, so put it into the chat. Okay. And give me a way that I can get back to you and I can give you more resources. Perfect. But there's wonderful books on teaching reading in two languages. Certainly David and Yvonne Freeman have a whole bunch of books on teaching reading in two languages, and their books are excellent. That's Heinemann. And Fred Genesee and Elsie Hamayan and I did one on dual language programs, but so did Sonia Soltero. So there's lots and lots of great books on biliteracy. So I want to make sure we explain to you about if you need this, I forget how you call them, CTLEs.
Yep, continuous learning and professional leadership, something like that. Clotilde's ready for that, I believe.
So Clotilde, if you could explain.
Yes, for the participants that need the CTLEs, you just if you did not put it in when you register, please put it in the chat. I will save the chat and I will see who needs them. Thank you.
Okay, so we all want to thank you very, very much for giving up this 3 hours this morning. It's a beautiful day. It's the first day of spring, and we want to release you to enjoy the day, but we thank you so much for giving of your time. It shows what kind of professional you are, and we want you to have credit for attending today for sure, so get those CTLEs, and also you know that we're available to you. There's my two emails, so you can contact me, and you have wonderful specialists at the Arburn at NYU. Take advantage, and thanks again for attending today, and I'll let whoever from the Arburn would like to wrap up do that.
Thank you, Nancy. Thank you for another great job. And everyone, let's please give Nancy a great hand, a thumbs up or applause. Another fantastic job. One of the things that we would like you to do, in addition to the CTLEs, please remember to fill out the evaluation that Samara will post in the chat. It helps us to help frame additional workshops or be more responsive to the needs that you have as instructors of English language learners. So we continue to provide as much as we can, but we'd like to hear from you. What would you need? What would you like? And again, another great hand for Nancy. Thank you, Nancy.
No problem. And I'd like to mention to those of you that are still on that we're going to do remote ELA instruction for transitioning ELLs on April 10th. I'm going to model with a fourth grade unit. And if you are in third grade, you have a chapter book, Peter Pan. So third grade and up, you're using chapter books, which I'll be modeling with. But if you are in a lower grade level, grade one or grade two, then for grade two, you might use the unit that we shared today on fossils and Mary Anning. And if you're in grade one, you might choose some of these more difficult texts, challenging texts for ELLs that are part of your grade one module two unit, What's Up in the Sky. So it's a big grade span. Next time I really want us to be able to work with student writing samples so we can see what they need and what kind of language we need to build. And so we'll be working with this fourth grade unit. I'm trying to hit between all the grade levels. So today we did 2 and 6. And next time we'll work right in the middle with a fourth grade unit, but it will feel comfortable from grade 3 and up because all of you are working with chapter books and novels. So thanks again, and we'll see you next time, maybe.